Welcome to episode 15 of VR Roundtable. This is a very special episode for us at VR Roundtable. We are going to do our 2016 Game of the Year Awards for the VR industry. Basically, we, of course, are covering the HTC Vive. We're covering PlayStation VR, and we are covering Oculus Rift. And in this year of 2016, this is kind of the first year of VR. We haven't even had these machines for an entire calendar year, but we have had them for a while, and we've tried a lot of different experiences, a lot of different games on the HTC Vive, on the PlayStation VR, and we've also tried some Oculus stuff via Revive. A few of us have some Oculus demos. I personally haven't, but we've been able to try a lot of games and a lot of experiences, and this is a show where we get to celebrate those games and experiences. What were the most impactful experiences that really left a lasting impression on us? And so this is our award show. One thing I do want to say real quick is our awards, these are not definitive awards by any stretch of the imagination. All three of us have played a limited set of games. We don't get to try every single game out there. We don't know about all the different games. So really what it is we're kind of giving our favorite games, the games that really talk to us. So we're not trying to say this is the definitive game of the year and everyone should bow down. You know, it's like we're each doing our awards. This is what our opinion is. We haven't tried everything. So just having that out there. All right, so we got a lot of awards. Gary is coming to us live from the United Kingdom. We've got Steve coming live from Louisville, Kentucky. I'm of course coming live from Sacramento, California. How's it going over there?
Pretty good, yeah. We're all set up ready for Christmas now. And I think the Steam sale has just gone live as well. So I'm looking forward to picking up a few titles on that. Although I can't get on at the moment. It's crashing every time I try.
Isn't it crazy? We do this award show, and then on the day of our award show, all these other games are coming out, or they came out yesterday or the day before. It's pretty crazy. Steve, how's it going over there in Louisville, Kentucky?
It's going good. Good time of year. I'm off of work now for a little bit, so I get to play some games. And other than a little dental appointment this morning, things are going good in my part of the country.
All right, your cheek is kind of drooping over here. Can you do something about that? No.
I'll get some, what they call it, Botox. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll do that at halftime. Deepen it up.
All righty. Well, we've got a lot of awards to get to, so why don't we just go ahead and get the show underway? What I will say before we get started is what I did was I told Steve and I told Gary, I said, look, why don't we rank our five favorite Vive games? And then me and Steve went ahead and ranked our five favorite PSVR games. We didn't get to play a ton of Oculus stuff, but I decided, why don't we rank our three favorite Oculus games as well? And so we have those lists that we're going to get into. And then we also have a lot of individual awards for a lot of different things. But what I decided to do is rather than just, oh, let's just list them all off one by one, we're going to kind of go through a flow and kind of work our way through the awards like that. So that's kind of how we're going to do it. So we're going to go ahead and start off our very first award. This is our fifth favorite Vive game. We ranked five of our favorites, and this is number five. This is the last one to make the list. Okay, I'll go ahead and say, Gary, your fifth favorite Vive game is Job Simulator. My fifth favorite Vive game is Raw Data. And Steve's favorite fifth favorite Vive game is Audio Shield. So I'll kick it off to Gary. Gary, Job Simulator, you put it in at number five. What's your thoughts?
Yeah, well, for this particular one, I mean, I want to just start by saying this list is, like you've said, it's personal choices all the way through. So it's not necessarily, I've tried not to take cues from what people have generally been enjoying online or anything like that. This is really my personal list. I will just say there is a small caveat to that with this one game on my list. Now, this is my fifth. I've put this down as my fifth favorite Vive game, Job Simulator. But I do really enjoy this game. But my total time in it has probably only been about 2 hours, something like that. And I would have been amiss in not including this purely for the amount of enjoyment and fun that my kids have got from this game. For some reason, this just draws them back again and again. And I couldn't not include this in my top games for the year. I've tried to introduce them. I mean, they don't spend a lot of time in VR by any means. It's sort of 15-minute sessions, maybe once or twice a week. So they don't spend a ton of time in there. But I've tried to introduce them to a few other games. My son enjoys Windlands as well. But for some reason, Job Simulator, it just really, really does keep drawing them back in. And they can role play within this game, pretend they really are a chef, and all these kinds of things. So, yeah, I think it's well-deserved a place on my list. So that's really my reasoning behind why I chose Job Simulator on that one.
All right, Steve, you have Audio Shield as the fifth on your list. Any quick little thoughts on that?
Basically, with Audio Shield, I chose it because it is very wide in genre. I don't think I put myself included in this game and they had a bad time. It just appeals to everybody, so long as you choose the right music for their taste and you can kind of dance a little bit. And it has a little bit of depth, so it was just a good general crowd pleaser, fan favorite.
All right, and I chose Raw Data as my fifth game, which is kind of weird because I don't actually own Raw Data. I'm going to go ahead and rank it fifth because there was that free weekend where we got like 3 or 4 days where you could play Raw Data, and I probably put like 5 hours into it over that 3 or 4 day period. So I feel like I got enough of a good look at Raw Data. And for me, what it is, it's just the polish. It's just the polish. It's a complete experience. It's pseudo AAA. And honestly, I will say that there were actually probably like 4 or 5 games I could have put right here. And Raw Data was just, I just felt it was just slightly better than the rest of the group. So that's why I have Raw Data there. Okay, so that is our first award there with the fifth favorite Vive game. Now we're going to get to our fifth favorite PlayStation VR game. And this is, me and Steve are doing this. We're PSVR owners, and so we went ahead and did a top five. Steve, your top five game is Thumper. And my top five game is Bound. Okay, so let's go to Steve first. Steve, what's your thoughts on Thumper in at number 5?
Similar to your number 5 game, I felt that there were a lot of titles I could have put here. And as I was making the list, I just kind of went back and said, you know, what did I just personally and try to forget any reasons why I enjoyed it? Just identify what I enjoyed. And so I went ahead and put Thumper, I think mostly because it's just unique, it's fun, it's quick, it's visceral, and I had a lot of fun with it.
All right. And I put Bound in there at number 5. And Bound, man, there's just something about Bound. That game, there's something magical about that game. There's been times where I've been playing Bound, and I get caught up in the visuals of it and just like this dream world that you're basically visiting someone else's psychedelic dream world. And it's realized to such a high level. But it's very simple. It's simplistic. There's not a lot of intricate designs everywhere. Everything is very simple. But I just get farther and farther into that game, and I see a new level with, like, purple rain is coming down, and I'm in this weird orange and gray environment, and I'm trying to do platforming on all these weird little jumping on these things that are moving and twisting. It's just such a interesting game. But the best thing that I could say about Bound is there were times when I was playing Bound where I actually stopped and said to myself, this is the best freaking VR game, period. This is number one. This is the number one VR game. This is the best. And coming out of that though, and after playing Bound and kind of thinking about it, it's not really that. But what it is when you're in there, when you're playing it, for me anyway, it's something about the art. It's something about the visuals, the music. Some of the music in Bound sounds a little bit like Stranger Things, that TV show. And then there's some musical tracks in Bound that really remind me of Tron Legacy. And it just has a really cool sound to it. And then you're this alien ballerina lady, I guess. I don't know exactly how it all works, but you're this ballerina lady that's kind of dancing around and you're jumping off this and you're jumping off that. But there are certain parts in the game where like she gets on this red carpet that just kind of is like zooming through the level and you're just zooming like a million miles per hour, like sliding down this like carpet or rope type of thing. And you're changing the camera angle constantly. And it's just, I'm looking at it, I'm like, God, this is incredible. Much props to the people that made Bound. I know it's like Santa Monica Studios, but it's this other smaller developer that worked with Santa Monica Studios. Whoever is the art direction guy, that my Academy Award goes to you. So that's why I ranked Bound fifth on my PSVR list. All right, so Steve, you have our first individual award.
All right, coming up next, the VR puzzle game of 2016. We have Gary has chosen Fantastic Contraption. Anthony has chosen the Super Hypercube demo. And I have chosen Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes, or No One Explodes. Gary, go ahead. Defend your choice.
Okay, yeah. I'm not a huge puzzle guy, to be honest. I don't really play a great deal of puzzle games, but this was an important category because there are quite a few little puzzle games within VR that you can choose between. But for me, this one, it's one of the first games that I played on my Vive when I got my Vive. Obviously, it was like in a bundle. And yeah, for me, it's just great. You really do feel like you're inventing something in this game. You can experiment quite a lot with all the different ways of getting the puzzle completed. And even when you do complete it, you can then go back and repeat the level and try and do it in a different way, a bit more of an imaginative way. So it really can keep you coming back. Again, it's not a game that I've spent a huge amount of time in, if I'm being honest, but I think it's got some really, really sound mechanics to it. And I do enjoy it every time I do delve into that game.
All right, Anthony.
Yeah, Super Hypercube. I actually have demo here, but I just got Super Hypercube like a day or so ago. So I actually have the full version now and I played it a little bit. And this is my pick and I feel pretty good about it. It's a very narrow focus game. If you have PlayStation VR and you've tried the Super Hypercube demo, you've basically played the game. That is the game. There isn't much else to it. It just gets more and more complex and just goes farther. But there is such a polish about like when the game first starts up and everything is kind of like this fake neon, almost what do they call it? Those games like Asteroids and stuff where it's like, I forget what they call it, like Raster or whatever or something. It just has this certain look to it, this retro look that is so, so nice. And it doesn't try to do a lot, but what it does is very good. It's basically like Tetris. You're kind of manipulating these shapes, and then it's kind of like that hole in the wall thing. You know those games like Wipeout where they have a hole in the wall and you got to like contort your body or whatever to fit through the hole? Super Hypercube demo basically does that, but with small Tetris shapes, squares that keep adding together and getting more and more complicated, and you kind of flip them around and roll them around, and then as soon as you feel like you got that right shape, you hit the button, and then boom, it goes through the wall, and hopefully you actually fit it through the wall, and it just gets more and more complex as it goes along, but I think it's a pretty solid game. I'm not a huge puzzle guy either, but this is one that I kind of like.
Very good. Okay, for me, Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes. It was an easy choice for me. There wasn't a quote-unquote puzzle game that I felt was better. It maybe could have fit in as a multiplayer game because it requires you to play with another person. But the game, just the way it causes you to interact, you know, when the person you're playing it with is shouting instructions at you, and the communication element of it as you try to solve these puzzles. You know, the puzzle isn't so much the game itself and the bomb you're trying to defuse. The puzzle is coming up with clever ways to communicate efficiently to whomever you're playing the game with. So this game was just one of the more fun games I played in VR, period. And considering the fact that it is doubly released on the Vive and Oculus and PSVR, it just made for a great choice, I think, here. And Gary, I think you're going to announce our next award.
Yep, the next one is the best use of haptic feedback or rumble in a VR game. And again, we've each chosen a different title for this one. So Anthony went for Job Simulator. I went for Longbow in the Lab. And Steve went for Batman Arkham VR. So why don't we kick it over to Anthony first? What specific part of Job Simulator did you choose?
Yeah, for me, this one is the convenience store clerk. You're working at like a gas station convenience store type thing, AM, PM or whatever. And what really stood out to me is there's a drawer that you open up and you slide it out, and there's like lottery tickets and stuff that are in there. There's a certain part where somebody wants to buy lottery tickets. You got to give them lottery tickets, blah, blah, blah. But there's this drawer that you slide open. And the action of sliding it open and sliding it closed, just, it's such a subtle little manipulation of all those little motors that are in there to give you that feeling of it's a very specific kind of drawer. And I've opened those kind of drawers and closed them. And it really felt like that. It really bought me into the experience. I was like, I kind of stopped when I was playing and was just like, wow, that is an amazing haptic feedback.
Okay. And Steve, why don't you tell us what it was about Batman Arkham VR that you thought was particularly good?
For me, you know, I guess I don't pay attention to the haptic feedback maybe as much as other people, but for me, Batman stood out just because it was so aggressive. When you, you know, kind of clear an area and you're going to go to the next area and you hop in the Batwing or the Batmobile, and the engine is roaring and all that, they really vibrated the controllers a whole lot to kind of, I guess in part because you weren't actually in the Batmobile or the Batwing, but to kind of give you that simulated feel of at least, you know, as if you were sitting in there and you felt the vibration. So that stood out to me, and it was really, I think, a good choice.
Yeah. Okay. And for me, yeah, the longbow section in the lab, this is probably quite an obvious choice. But, you know, when you first get these VR headsets, the HTC Vive, certain aspects of it seem to stand out more to you when you first experience them. And for me, the lab was one of the first titles that I chose to play. And yeah, Longbow, within that, the haptic just really, really stood out to me. And that has stuck with me up until now. I was really struggling to think of anything else that superseded that in between. And yeah, the feeling, like you were saying, Anthony, with just the subtle use of the motors, just to make that really feel like you're pulling that longbow back before you shoot the arrows out, it's not really been matched in any of these other archery games as far as I'm concerned. And I've not tried them all, so I can't say that categorically. But yeah, for me, that was just something that really, really stood out to me when I first got my Vive. Okay. And yeah, the next award is Anthony's going to announce that one.
Yeah. So the next one we have is, this is a interesting one here, best individual VR demo material. And we all know what this is about, because it's like, if you have a cousin or a nephew or somebody's coming over to your house for the first time, they've never tried VR, and you're like, oh man, I should show them blah, 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 you know? And so it's like that go-to demo material that you always go to show somebody and kind of blow them away, like why VR is so cool. So Steve on this one picked The Lab, which is a great choice, of course. Gary went with Google Earth, and I went with the T-Rex from Dream Deck. So let's go ahead and kick it over to Steve. Steve, tell us about The Lab. Which part of The Lab do you put people into?
So as we were going through this, you know, one of the things that I wanted to do was to limit The Lab to individual choices of the sub games in there. And as I kept thinking about demoing, I couldn't choose one. And it's because I think the little sub games that I put people in, it varies depending on the person. You know, for a younger kid, I put them on the mountain and playing with a little robot dog. For the more gamer types, I put them in either Longbow or Zortex 2066. Kind of more of a general, you know, non-gamer but older person, I put them in the, and I can't think of the name of the game, but the one where you go in the little magic shop and you shrink down and things like that. So for me, it was the lab as a whole. I just think it was developed from Valve to be demo material. It appears to be something, a collection of little things that they put together during their testing and development, and they polished it really good. And once you teach someone the teleport mechanics, you can kind of set them in it and walk away. And, you know, they can come back an hour later and after they've tried everything. And it's just, it's a very wide reaching and very good for the initial exposure to VR, I think.
All right, Gary, you got Google Earth.
Yeah, and like Steve was saying, really, this it depends a lot on the person that you're demoing to what you put them in. But for me, just thinking back of a lot of people that have come around to try it, you know, my parents and my sister has come around to try it. I'm just thinking, what kind of experience would they like to go in? And this Google Earth actually wasn't out when I demoed it to them. But Google Earth is something that they're already familiar with, just using it on a desktop or an iPad or something like that. So for me, I think this is a great little demo to experience in VR, just to how it contrasts so well to the desktop or the iPad experience. And it can really give people a flavor. They know what the application is, they know what it's for, they know what it does. So they can really focus in on the VR aspect of it to get a really good idea of what VR is. So that's really why I chose Google Earth for this category.
All right. And I went with the, there's a thing called Dream Deck that Oculus has, which is kind of like the lab. It has a collection of little mini things that you can experience that just kind of go one into the other. And one of them, there is a T-Rex where it's basically you're looking down like a museum hallway and you hear loud noises coming around a corner. And then, you know, you see a T-Rex and then it comes kind of almost running at you. It stops and breathes on you, the whole deal. A lot of people have been through this. I just feel like it is one of those wow moments that a lot of people can have. And sometimes I'll have a group of people over my house and I'll be like, okay, who's going to do the T-Rex demo? And I almost make it like a challenge. Like, come on, you know, are you going to chicken out? Or are you going to check out this T-Rex? And most people are able to put the headset on. And then sometimes they're like, oh, I can't deal with it. And they take the headset off or whatever. But I just feel like the T-Rex is a cool demo. I would have maybe said the blue, which used to be my go-to demo. The only reason I don't have the blue here, though, is because I have a lot of trouble getting in and out of the blue for whatever reason. Like, you got to, like, sign in on the webs. You know, there's just lots of little... Whenever I try to start up the blue, it doesn't just work. But I don't actually own the blue. I only have the demo, so maybe that's part of it. All right, Gary, you got the next award.
Yeah, this one is the best cockpit game of 2016. And yeah, we've all chosen different titles for this one as well. So I went for Elite Dangerous. Steve went for Riggs on the PlayStation VR. And Anthony went for Eve Valkyrie on the PlayStation VR. And let's just kick this straight back to Anthony. Why did you go for Eve Valkyrie on this?
I had Eve Valkyrie for a period of time. Got it through Gamefly. Don't have it right now, but it is one of these games where if it's ever discounted in a major way, it's a game I'm going to go back to because the gameplay was there. I had a lot of fun with it. Just the cockpit of being in this spaceship and maneuvering around asteroids and going around giant motherships. And I tried a bunch of different cockpit experiences. The Jackal thing for Call of Duty, the Star Wars cockpit demo thing for the Rogue One, Battlezone. I've been in a lot of different cockpits, and I just like the Eve Valkyrie cockpit. So,
okay, yeah, and let's go over to hear from Steve about Riggs because this is one that I'm interested to play if I ever get a PlayStation VR. So, yeah, let's see your thoughts on that.
For me, this was a tough choice. My runner-up was going to be the Star Wars Rogue One experience, mostly because of the how fully featured the cockpit is. I went with Riggs, and it isn't as fully featured of a cockpit, but what it does well, and why when I gave it the nudge, is it has a heads-up display that's kind of part of the cockpit's windshield sort of screen. And that heads-up display is very functional and valuable to the game itself. And the way they overlay the score and various status type things, it's just very, very functional and beneficial to the player. And it's not just there for cosmetics. So I went ahead and gave it to Riggs for that reason alone.
Okay, cool. And this one I went for Elite Dangerous. You know, the thing about this category, the best cockpit game, we haven't got a specific racing game category in this list. And looking through the list, I didn't really suggest we include a racing game category, only because first of all, I don't think any of us are really huge into racing games for a start, but also there's a very limited choice to choose from. So I just want to quickly say that, because I want to make a quick honorable mention to Assetto Corsa for this. For me, it's the best racing game that I've tried in VR. It's not flawless, because you have problems with the menu only displaying on a monitor. It doesn't work with the menu in VR. But when you're actually in the race, for me, Assetto Corsa is really one of the best racing games to try in VR. It works. The performance is excellent. And it's just got a really good feel about it. So I just wanted an honorable mention for that. But for my choice on the best cockpit game, it has to go to Elite Dangerous. It wasn't a difficult choice at all, but I won't spend too long on it. It's just a great game. I'm a big space guy, and to be in the cockpit of a spacecraft, which is something I've always wanted since I was a kid, you know, this Elite Dangerous just brings it to life better than any other game I can think of, really. That's why I chose Elite Dangerous. Okay, and let's go over to Steve. You've got our next award, I believe.
So our next award is Best Narrative or Story in a VR Game. And this category is kind of important to me. You probably hear me talk about it a lot. I think, you know, with a lot of these VR games and gaming in general, I've always felt the need to have a purpose to be doing whatever it is I'm doing. And getting into VR earlier this year, that's been exacerbated because there's so many VR titles that just throw you into whatever the mechanic is. All of the focus is on the mechanic, and I really appreciate a good story and a setting and a reason to be doing whatever it is I'm doing. So Gary has chosen The Gallery. Anthony has also chosen The Gallery, so we have our first kind of conclusive individual award here. And then I chose Robinson the Journey. So I'm going to head and kick it back to Gary.
Okay, yeah, this one for me, it's something in VR, narrative is something we're a little bit starved of in many ways in a lot of VR titles. So the list to choose from in this is quite short, but I think The Gallery has a very deserved place is the top of this category. It's a story which it's not a straightforward story, but as you get through it, with a lot of games really, you get sort of grasps and just a progression of what's going on as you go through the game. And yeah, the story in this game is good, and as you get towards the end, it starts to change and the tone changes throughout the game as well, something that I like. And it's all narrative based. This is the thing, the tone changes based on what's happening within the narrative. And at the very end, you know, you've got this a great ending. I won't spoil it, but again, the tone of that ending is completely different to the rest of the game, I feel. And it's all explained very, very well. It does make you want to know what's going to happen in episode 2 of this. So I think it's got a deserved place on this list.
Okay, Anthony, go ahead.
Yeah, so on this award, I have to be honest and say that there actually wasn't any game that I wanted to choose for this award. And I struggled, I really tried to think about all the various games I played to try to think, is there any VR game that has really had a great narrative? And I don't think there has been, really. But of the ones that I played, I would give it to The Gallery. I mean, The Gallery stands out. I think The Gallery stands out because there's just such a lack of this across the board anywhere that when you finally get somebody that actually makes a legitimate attempt to have some type of story, it actually stands out and is seems maybe better than it really is. I think the gallery is okay, the narrative for that. But I just don't feel like there's really anything in this category, but I know we had to pick something. So I went ahead and went with the gallery.
Okay, good. I chose Robinson the Journey, and like Anthony and both Gary, I felt that there wasn't a lot of great choices on the table, but I wanted to call some attention to the category as a whole. So I've also played the gallery, and it was very close, and A Chair in the Room was also very close for me. But I went ahead and gave it to Robinson because I think it sold me on purpose a little more. There's a reason why you were this character on this planet, and even though the narrative doesn't unfold sort of in game time as you explore and play the game, it's told to you through the voice recordings and things that you find. As I went through and found each area and found those voice recordings, it gave purpose, and that's really what made me choose this. It felt sort of real. It felt like something that it could happen, even though it's, you know, deals with space and you know, on a alien planet. So I gave the nod to Robinson, and I think it was one of very few narrative games that you could qualify with some narrative in them. And I'm going to now kick it to Anthony for our next award.
Okay, so we're back to our Vive top five list, and this will be the fourth favorite Vive game. Steve went ahead and picked Space Pirate Trainer. Gary went with Gallery Episode 1, Call of the Starseed. And I chose Cyber Pong. So why don't we kick it back to Steve again real quick and tell us a little bit about Space Pirate Trainer.
So much like my fifth top game, Audio Shield, Space Pirate Trainer is kind of a fan favorite. I chose it because it allows you to do something that you kind of want to do in real life, and that's being a dual wielding space ninja badass. And you know, and this game delivers. There is no narrative. There is no anything. The graphics are kind of middling compared to a lot of VR games, but what it aims to do, it does really well, and it puts you on a platform and you're shooting little space robot things, and it has the bullet time effect, which is one of the first games that I personally played that had that effect. It has, you know, even though it can be very deep if you want to pursue leaderboard rankings, it has a small learning curve. So you can put someone in it who doesn't play games, someone who isn't familiar with VR, you can put them in there, hand them the controllers and say, shoot those things. And for that reason, and because most people love it, I chose Space Pirate Trainer.
All right, Gary, I know you were just talking about Gallery, the story. What else about Gallery appealed to you?
Well, I think the reason I chose this one for my fourth favorite Vive game is because as a complete package, I think overall this one is one of the better and more polished complete packages within VR. And it came out at the very beginning, and a lot of people were talking about it because it had those aspects, really. And, you know, it's got some great graphics. It's got NPC interaction, pretty good voice acting as well. As I say, for me, this is the complete package, especially early on. And yeah, that's really my main reasons for choosing this one.
All right. And I went with Cyber Pong, which is kind of weird. But basically what happened for me is I was looking at my list of how many hours I spent in all of the various games. And I spent a lot of time in Cyber Pong. And there was this like 2 month stretch of when I owned the Vive where every time I turned on my Vive, Cyber Pong was the first game that I would play. And for me, what it is about Cyber Pong that I like so much, it's basically like this Pong game that you're hitting. You have two paddles and you're hitting a ball and you're trying to break up these blocks. And it's kind of like Breakout. It's kind of like a Breakout game where you're trying to break up these blocks, but there's so much more to it. I mean, that's what you could just say on the surface level, But what it really is this is a game that you're going to be really active in, and you have to be coordinated, and you're going to be moving around, and you're going to be trying to hit a ball over here and hit a ball over here and then quickly hit a ball down there. And you're moving all around, and it's a very physical game. You might get a little bit sweaty. It's one of these accidental exercise games. I kind of call it accidental exercise because you'll get a little bit of exercise out of it. But what's really special about it for me is it's kind of a thinking man's game in that category, from the standpoint that when you're hitting back these balls, you have to be very cognizant of the different blocks that you hit. There's different colored blocks, and the different blocks do different things. A red block, you hit a red block, it explodes, and it can explode some of the blocks that are right near it. You hit a green block, it releases another ball. You hit a purple block, it releases a power up. And all these blocks are moving forward, and eventually they'll hit this like imaginary line, and it's basically game over. And in the very beginning, it takes a long time for the blocks to get anywhere near you. But as you go through the game, the blocks start moving faster and faster. And what you have to do is you have to make these calculations in your head, like angles, like, okay, I need to ricochet the ball off that part of the wall so that it'll then go and hit that block there. And a lot of times when these blocks start moving quickly, if you make a mistake, you're done. You have to, you know what I mean? You're constantly looking at every different block and trying to think, okay, do I want this power up block? No, let me save that red block so I can create an explosion over there. If I hit another one of these green blocks, damn, I'll have so many balls. Sometimes you're juggling like 9 balls at a time, and that's a great quote, I know. But you'll be in this game and you'll be juggling a crazy amount of balls. And that's where you get crazy exercise. Because like if somebody saw you from the outside, you would look like a total spaz when you're playing this game. But I have much love for Cyber Pong. It dominated my playtime for a good 2 months. All right. That's our fourth favorite Vive game. Our fourth favorite PSVR game for me and Steve, I went ahead and went with Eagle Flight, and Steve went with Batman Arkham VR. So, Steve, what is it about Batman Arkham VR that put it at number 4 for you?
The short answer is you become Batman. In the story, you become Batman. I put it fourth, and it could have been, I think, the best game if it had been a little more full featured. So I put it fourth because of the things that it did really, really well. And we have done no shortage of talking about it here on the show. The one thing that stands out is the characters, for everything from the guy in the beginning that shoots your parents, to the Penguin, to the Joker, to Killer Croc. They all just look really good, and they take up real space, and they feel real when they're in front of you. It has a good little story to it. It's kind of retreading familiar Batman territory there. The scanning and the detective work that you do is, it feels good, and it's understandable as why it's limited in length, because that would get very repetitive if you were trying to do that for 6 hours or something like that. So the game as a whole is really good. I think is a great experience. I think it's good exposure, a good kickoff into VR for hopefully Rocksteady to do more with Batman itself or other kind of licensed properties or whatever they come out with next. But the big standout and something we keep going back to is just the way the characters felt and how they just seem so real and were top notch.
All right. And I went ahead and picked Eagle Flight. And for me, basically what it was, Eagle Flight is one of these games that I kind of did not give this game a lot of respect at the very beginning. And it's the more I play it, the more it has grown on me. And it's a narrow focus game where you're an eagle and you're flying around. And it's kind of a flight simulator, kind of a mix between like a Pilot Wings and a combat kind of a flight simulator. It's been skinned where you're basically an eagle and you're flying over a deserted Paris in the future and stuff like that. And it's just the polish of the game. And one of the things about it is of every VR game, like this is across the board of all the VR games I played, One cool thing about Eagle Flight, and this might just be like a Ubisoft thing, where you know how they Assassin's Creed and what's that other franchise that they have? Where they always have the towers, you know, you go to towers and you get a million different little missions that you got to do. And they kind of do the same thing with Eagle Flight. And there's something about having all these missions to participate in that makes it seem more like a full featured title. You know what I mean? And in VR, we don't really have a lot of games that like really feel like they're fully featured and they bring a lot to the table and there's a lot to feast on. And when I turn on Eagle Flight, I feel like there's a lot of little different things that I can do in the game. And I feel like I'm kind of progressing through a story. And I know they kind of just take little goofy things and make them as missions to kind of string you along, but they do a damn good job of it. And it's the production value. And it's really, the music is incredible. The musical score, there are certain times in this game where you'll be soaring through Paris and the musical score is ramping up and it's like timed perfectly with you like soaring right through under this bridge or whatever. And it just has a magical feel to it. So that's kind of why I got Eagle Flight at number 4. All right, Gary, you got the next individual award.
Yep, this one is the best VR Pong game of 2016. And again, we've all got different titles. Steve went for Hollow Ball, Anthony went for Cyber Pong, and I went for 11 Table Tennis VR. And I'll kick this one off because, to be honest, 11 Table Tennis, it is a Pong game. It's a ping pong game, I suppose. But I was a bit unsure on whether this one really qualified for this category. But I guess it does. And I had to include a table tennis game in this because there's been quite a few that have come out for the Vive, especially since VR launched. And I've tried pretty much all of them, I think. But the big thing with table tennis games is the physics. It has to be right, and it's very easy to detect if you're used to playing table tennis when it's not right. So we had sort of a steady progression as time went on and new table tennis games were coming out over the months. And the Paddle Up was one of the first ones that really got it quite close. It was never perfect, but it got it quite close. And I played Paddle Up for quite a while. But then a game called 11 joined forces with another one called Ping Pong Waves VR. They both sort of collaborated to make this game called 11 Table Tennis VR. And for me, the physics, absolutely the closest you're going to get in VR at the moment. And it's what sets this game apart. Also, the multiplayer is exceptionally good in this game. It's very smooth. You get the odd little glitch on the multiplayer, but it doesn't have any big problems. And I really do enjoy playing this game. It sort of took over a little bit from, I used to play a lot of Pool Nation VR as a multiplayer sort of sports game, I guess. But this really took over from that. If I just want to go into VR for sort of 10, 15 minutes, then this is probably the game that I'll go in for. And yeah, I really do enjoy this game. It definitely deserved to be on my list. But let's go over to Steve now. So see if he can talk a little bit about Hollow Ball.
So personally, I guess I'm either not as big of a fan of this genre of games or what, because I haven't played most of these other titles. But I did choose Hollow Ball because I played it both on PSVR and on Vive. And I believe with the Touch, it's now available on Oculus. So one of the things that I appreciate as I choose a title is that it's available for all consumers to get a chance to play it. And I think that means something. So Hollow Ball itself, you know, it's just a good game. It's simple. It's kind of stripped down. You have, you know, I forget the easiest level. I think they call it something other than easy. But then, you know, easy, medium, hard, and it progresses. It's very straightforward and very good. And you can work up a sweat. And the Tron-like graphics of it and the setting that it provides and the kind of the autonomous voiced red box that you're competing against that kind of has very little to say, but still says a little bit, you know, and looking up to the scoreboard where you look straight up to the sky and the way it's kind of projected over the sky. So I think as an early VR title, it did a good job of having simple but effective gameplay, but it also did a good job of demonstrating a sense of scale, which is something, another element that I really hone in on a game is a sense of scale. And you know, as you start in the earlier levels, it the box or the grid that you're in is smaller. And I distinctly remember going from easy to medium, and you step into the medium arena and it stretched back and it grew in size. And I remember just thinking like, oh, wow. Like, you know, it was one of those kind of happy VR giddy moments. And I think Hollow Ball is a great game, and I'm glad everybody with a VR headset has an opportunity to play it.
Yeah, it's a great game. Okay, Anthony, this is titled Cyberpunk. You've already spoken a little bit about, but
I've already talked about Cyberpunk quite a bit. One quick little thing I will say about it, though, is as much as I played it back in the day, I would have some problems every once in a while. Like, you know how I was telling you I'd be juggling 8 or 9 balls and you're like moving all over and stuff? Sometimes when that was happening, there were so many objects that were moving simultaneously that it would get kind of like framey and stuff, and there would be some performance problems, and it would kind of get like reprojection and all that stuff. Like there were certain parts in Cyberpunk where it would get annoying for me. And I don't know if it's because I got a 970, I don't got the highest PC rig that's out there. My processor is an old processor, stuff like that. That could have possibly been part of it. But you know how Valve added the asynchronous time warp, their version of it, recently? I enabled that, and I turned off the interleave one, and I enabled the other one, and I tried Cyberpunk, and it was smooth as butter. It was so awesome. So the only thing I'll quickly say about Cyberpunk is if you find a really good deal for Cyberpunk, try it, man. I really think it, but it's one of these games where you're going to have to learn it to truly appreciate it. You might play it for 5 minutes and think this is not that great, but if you really learn the subtleties of it.
Okay, Steve, over to you for our next award.
So our next, this is a game show. We're doing our game awards, but the VR industry as a whole has an opportunity to service more than just games, and it has an opportunity to service software, applications, things for, you know, maybe if you're an architect or an engineer or things of that sort. So our next category is best application / software tool of 2016. Gary and I both chose Google Earth, and Anthony chose Revive. So let's go ahead and kick it to Anthony so he can talk about that.
Yeah, my choice is kind of a lame choice, really. I honestly couldn't think of anything in this particular category that really stood out to me. Revive, of course, really stands out to me. Much loved across VR, the guy that has worked tirelessly on Revive and has brought so many of the Vive owners out there the ability to experience some of the Oculus stuff as well. So much props to Revive, but yeah, I didn't really have a good pick for this one.
All right.
So Gary, Go back to Steve or Gary for Google Earth.
Yeah. Well, I've already spoken a little bit about how Google Earth is good for demoing, in my opinion. And Anthony just mentioned Revive. I mean, that didn't even cross my mind to pick that for this category, but I think that's a great choice, to be honest. If I'd have thought of it, it would have definitely been on my list to put into this category, because it is an application that makes life as a HTC Vive owner a lot easier. But with regards to my choice of Google Earth VR, it's just, I think more than anything, when I play this game, well, it's not a game, but when I go into Google Earth VR, more than anything, I'm just thinking of the potential of it for the future, because you know, at the moment it's excellent for what it is at the moment, but you just have thoughts of where it's going to be in sort of 3 years, 4 years, 5 years down the line, where you can really zoom into sort of street level and explore all these places if you really are there, when we've got high resolution screens with bigger field of view, and you can explore this application where they've got much more detailed buildings. it's just incredible. And it's one that I do go back to quite often. And I mentioned at the beginning of the show how Job Simulator is something that, that my kids really enjoy. This is another title my son really enjoys, going into Google Earth and just exploring different places. So yeah, it really is one of the better ones to come out over the past month or so.
Yeah, for me, you know, when Google Earth was kind of stealth released, I don't think anybody knew this was coming. I certainly didn't. The front page of Vive Reddit was just covered with Google Earth topics, and there were people saying, you know, I had tears in my eyes, and you know, there's a lot of sensationalism. And I think we even kind of mocked it a little bit on the show. But that aside, it did kind of hit me. I didn't cry, but you know, I went into it, and first thing I did is I kind of flew around and checked out New York City. And then I went to my neighborhood, and I kind of distinctly remember just kind of sitting down on the floor in the room where I had my VR set up and just kind of explored my neighborhood. And it was really, really cool and really impressive. And I think it gives us a little glimpse of what is potential, you know, what is possible in using VR and using this kind of technology. So it got my pick for best application. And I also talked about it with my sister-in-law getting married soon in Hawaii, how it actually served as a tool for her in choosing the location of where she's going to do her wedding ceremony. So it's software tool. It is good, and it's not a game. And I think it's one of the best things to be available that wasn't a game. And I think the next category goes to Anthony.
Okay, yeah. The next category that we have is VR demo of 2016. And this is not a demo to show somebody else. This is just like a demo that we can download and play. What is the best VR demo that we played in 2016? Gary went with budget cuts, and I went with budget cuts, and Steve goes with Resident Evil 7. So why don't we kick it over to Gary?
Okay, yeah, I think this was one of the easiest categories for me again. I've not played the Resident Evil 7 demo, so that didn't factor in, but the budget cuts is just incredible, really. It's such got such basic graphics, and yet the immersion from those graphics, which are just blocks, really, is incredible. They've created a world, and the teleportation mechanic is utilized so well in this game. It becomes a part of the game, and it's not just something, as we see in some of these other games, where you teleport just to get around because that's how they have to do it. In this game, it's a real mechanic which affects gameplay in very big ways. So for me, and we said this isn't just a VR demo of 2016 for us personally. I actually demoed this game to my nephew, and well, I demoed a whole range of games to him. He's 19 years old, and for him, this is the one that really, really stuck out. This was something that was on the next level. He couldn't stop playing this game, and from that point on, I really saw what was special about this game. It's just something, the way it's designed is something to do. You really feel like you're there. And again, you're in this world which looks nothing like real life, and yet they've created something special where you do really feel like you're in that place.
Yeah, for me, budget cuts, this is one of those things where we forget about something like budget cuts because it's been available since the very beginning, right? It's crazy to think that budget cuts was this demo that was available like right when the Vive launched. Here we are, I don't know how many months later, we have no idea when this game is actually coming out, but it's absolutely one of the most wanted Vive games that's coming next year without question. And when you're in this game, it's just the immersion. You really do get lost in the experience. And Gary was saying that the graphics are nothing to write home about, but to me, what it is you're in like an office hallway, you know what I mean? And we've all been in an office hallway, and it's just walls, and there's carpet, and there's nothing extravagant about it. And it's something about how their rendering engine or something, it just looks so natural. It just seems so solid. There's times where I almost leaned up on a wall and then like fell over because I was like trying to sneak around, you know, and like get really close to this wall. And the robots and stuff, I mean, how many people freaked out the very first time they saw one of those robots that are life size, like as big as you? You can pick the things up when they're dead. You can pick them up by their arm and swing them around, and it's taken up a large amount of space even when it's a dead robot. So budget cuts is just awesome. Steve, RE7 is no slouch either. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, first let me say we were incredibly close to having a consensus budget cuts pick. I was 49-51 with my choice going RE7. So I ended up leaning RE7, Resident Evil 7, because I felt that with budget cuts that some of it was because VR was new. Is one of the first things that we all played. And I was trying to think back. I should have went back and actually played budget cuts again to make this comparison more fair. But RE7, I felt, was if it can give me this lasting impression now, you know, this many months later, and its impression has to be on the weight of the game and of the demo itself, and not on just because it's VR. And I think with budget cuts, that some of it, it's a very, very good game. But it was kind of, some of its greatness was just because you were in real space peeking around corners and poking your head through holes. So that novelty's kind of wore off on me. And Resident Evil 7 still impressed me after having months of VR exposure. And another factor that I chose with RE7 is because of the actual demo that they give you yourself. Itself is very deep, and you can replay it and do different things. And you know, if you were a big enough kind of nerd for it, you could probably get 5 hours of playtime out of this demo. And I think that was an incredible decision by Capcom.
All right, Gary, you've got the next award.
Yep, and this one is quite a difficult category, really, to choose, but it's VR Shooter of 2016. And this is one where we did get a clear winner. It was Doom 3 BFG VR mod. Both myself and Anthony went for Doom 3 BFG VR mod, and Steve went for Arizona Sunshine. So let's go ahead and hear from Anthony. What did you enjoy about the Doom 3 mod?
Yeah, Doom 3 BFG, you know, we were talking about earlier the narrative and stuff, and I was also talking about how Eagle Flight is such a cool game because it feels like it's a complete cohesive experience. And Doom 3 BFG, this is a game from, 2004, I believe? So it's like 12 years old. It's an old game, and when you're in there and you're playing it in VR, you'll see certain things that remind you like, oh yeah, this is a 12-year-old game. But it does have a story. It has a bit of a story. You're doing things and then just being inside that Doom world. And the room scale is so cool because the way I played this, it's the locomotion is basically like thumbstick type locomotion. And whenever I play thumbstick locomotion, I like to stand up like I'm really standing up in the world. And then what I do is I just try to go forward mostly. And what I'll do is I'll just turn my body in whatever direction I want to go forward in. And with room scale and the HTC Vive, that works so great. With PlayStation VR, it sometimes can be difficult a little bit when you start turning around and stuff. But with room scale, just being in this Doom world and seeing the flashing lights, and you know, you're in this dark hallway and the lights are flashing red because of some warning went off, and there's like steam that's coming out of this pipe, and sometimes you have to crawl through little nooks and crannies like you're in the movie Aliens, and there are creepy ass things that jump out of strange locations that'll freak the living daylights out of you. So I absolutely gave it to Doom 3 BFG.
Yeah, I'll just comment on that one as well, because we both had the same choice for this category. But yeah, for me, it was a big surprise when this came out. First of all, I wasn't expecting it to come out. And when it did come out, I wasn't really expecting it to have full room scale, motion controller support, or any of these things. So it was a very pleasant surprise when I tried this. And it feels as if it's built for VR in many ways, not in every way, but in many ways. The integration of VR within this game is incredible when you consider, as you say, it's sort of, what, 12 years old, something like that. It's just amazing how they've got it to work so well with this technology. And I keep going back to it. I really do enjoy it. Again, I've said it before, I play it in short bursts because I can't handle the intensity of the jump scares constantly. But it's, yeah, great game and thoroughly deserved. Okay, so Steve, you went for Arizona Sunshine for this category. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Okay, well, I'll say that as the faithless elector here in this category, you know, I very well could have chosen Doom 3 BFG, but for whatever blank and damn reason, it didn't come to my mind. So I went with Arizona Sunshine because, you know, it's just the shooting mechanics felt good. The, you know, taking out the zombies feels good. It felt good as a shooter. It had a good balance of gun manipulation and where you have to eject the cartridges and kind of think about it a little bit instead of just holding down the triggers a la Serious Sam or something. But it wasn't overly complicated like more of the simulators where you have to cock the pin and you kind of lose sight of what you're trying to shoot because you're busy handling the gun. So I felt it gave a good balance to that. And as a shooter, it felt pretty solid.
Yeah. Okay. And Steve, you've got our next award, I believe.
So with VR, we've had this uptick in a certain category of game that was always somewhat popular, but not to this degree, and that's in horror. So our next category is That Scared the Shit Out of Me Award. And we have a little bit of consensus with Gary and myself choosing A Chair in the Room, and Anthony has chosen Until Dawn, Rush of Blood. So I want to go ahead and kick it over to Anthony since he's the defector here. And
yeah, I don't have A Chair in the Room. So that's part of the, you know, with this whole awards thing is like not all of us have played every single thing. And then we all did our awards in private so that we wouldn't influence anyone else's decision and stuff like that. But I think it worked out pretty good. I went with Until Dawn, Rush of Blood, and the specific moment that scared the crap out of me. And this is a spoiler warning for anybody that has not played Until Dawn, Rush of Blood, or doesn't want anything at all spoiled. I'm going to talk for a second about the very ending of the spider level. Okay. So if you don't want that spoiled, maybe skip ahead like 2 minutes or something like that. Okay. So there's this spider level in Until Dawn, and it is one of the freakiest levels I've ever dealt with. I have a fear of spiders. Like, I'll just straight up admit it. I'm not scared of like every little spider that crawls around. Like, daddy long legs don't bother me. Even like those hairy, you know, those spiders that jump, those really hairy ones, like those wolf spiders, they can look hella scary, but those don't scare me. What scares me is the spiders like a black widow, something that has like those creepy legs and then that big ass butt, which I know it's not technically the butt, but those kind of spiders scare the freak out of me. And in Until Dawn, Rush of Blood, they basically have a level. It's not black widows, but it's like these giant tarantulas that have these big, big giant butts, and they're all over the place in this level. There's small ones, big ones, gigantic ones, like all different sizes. But it's the very, very end that scared the crap out of me, because basically you battle this gigantic spider and you're battling him for a long time. You finally kill the guy. You think the level is over and you think, oh, I won. Everything's great. And then all of a sudden, a million freaking little spiders come. You're in this roller coaster seat basically, and they just swarm everywhere. I had the headset on, and that headset was off and flew like maybe 5 feet across the room, and I did not care if I broke my PSVR. I was like, oh, you know, I threw that headset off. I was scared like you would not believe. So there's the end of spoiler talk.
Okay, Gary?
Okay, yeah. Well, it's not really the end of spoiler talk because here we go. But for me, a chair in the room in this specific part, because I've not played through the whole of that game yet. I've got a fair way through. I've played quite a few hours of it, but I'm not all the way through. And for me, there's so many parts of that game that could have won this award. But the bit that stuck out to me in this game is the part where you're in a hotel or a motel or something like that. And you're in a very sort of, it's a dark, dank room, and you've got a TV in that room which intermittently displays sort of static noise, or you have some kind of news report going on in the background. It's very similar to, I don't know if anybody played PT, but you have this news report going on in the background. But between those sections, you alternate between the hotel room and then the corridor just outside the hotel room. And in the corridor, you've got these pictures on the wall, three pictures, which uneasy in tone, and you can look down the corridor. There's not a great deal to do, but then you go back to the room again, and the room has changed slightly. And gradually throughout this whole section, the level of unease and just eeriness just builds and builds, and you've got this subtle music in the background as well, which really puts you on edge. And eventually you go out to this corridor again, and various things have happened before this, but you go out to this corridor again, and the pictures on the wall, all the faces of the people in the pictures have all melted. And then it will suddenly, you'll have this sudden loud noise, and all the lights will go out, then they'll flash on, and you'll see this girl or creature sort of crawling towards you. And it's in a game which sort of specializes in subtlety in many ways, this is sort of a standout moment where you don't expect this to happen, because you don't see anything like this up until this point. So yeah, that was just one section that really stood out to me in the game that I've played so far anyway.
Yeah, I can second that section, but I have a different one that I had in mind. So in a different part of the game, spoilers continuing, you are in a hotel room. And in order to advance, you have to go into a bathroom. And Gary, I hope you've played this part, so you may want to skip yourself. But in the bathroom, you kind of have the typical foggy mirror puzzle where you're looking for the code to a safe. And you got to go over and turn water in the bathtub on, or sink or something, and the mirror fogs up to reveal a code. Well, after it reveals the code, you turn around, and let me back up a second. This bathroom, all the lights are off, and you're just kind of, you got this flickering light, you see a little bit of light from under the door, and I think you maybe have a flashlight with you. So it's dark, it's dank, the mood is creepy as hell. And then you solve the puzzle, and then you just get this quick flash, and there's all of a sudden the silhouette of something standing in the bathtub, and it's there for like maybe 1.5 seconds, and then another quick flash, and it's gone. And that just speaks to what they can do in VR, because again, we always talk about how the creatures and objects take up space. Well, this thing was there, it was taking up space, and it can do things that defy physics in real life. And it just, I remember being creeped the hell out, and I know the hair on my arm was standing up, and it was just a very, very good execution. And as Gary mentioned, it's they have a way of being subtle in their horror elements in that game, and this was subtle. It was quick. It was fast, but it had an impact. So our next one goes to Gary.
Okay, yeah, this one is a big one. The best graphics in a VR game, and in again, we've all chosen different titles with this category. So Steve went for The Blue. I went for Showdown on the Oculus Rift, and Anthony went for Robinson the Journey on PSVR. So let's go to Anthony for this one first.
Yeah, so Robinson the Journey, back when we were, one of the episodes we had where we kind of did a long talk on Robinson the Journey, one thing that I mentioned is the graphics in Robinson the Journey can vary from what I think is some of the most incredible graphics I've seen in VR, and then also some really kind of bad graphics and kind of like textures that aren't like super high end, like almost PlayStation 2-ish kind of textures. But there are certain things in Robinson the Journey that is incredible. And the biggest one to me is you have a robot friend named Higgs, and it's this circular ball that is always like hovering around, and he talks to you and says, oh, we probably should go do this, or we probably should go do that. And he kind of follows you around and kind of talks to you throughout the game. And this Higgs unit, this robot, you will sometimes stand there and look at it. And I give all the props to Crytek with this engine. Whatever they did with that ball, they threw a lot of polygons and a lot of whatever on that ball to make it look incredibly real. Like on the face of this robot, there's like a glass covering. And then under the glass covering, you see like four or five cameras that can kind of move around, like the robot's like looking at different things. I don't know if they actually move, but you see the cameras under there. And there's like reflections off the glass and just the shininess. And when it flies over me and I look up at it, it looks so real sometimes that it just puts me there. The immersion is so good because it's like, I don't know, the light that shines off it or whatever. There's something about that Higgs unit. And then one other thing I'll say real quick is the very beginning of the game, when you're inside like this space pod that you kind of crash landed in, there is equipment and stuff that's all over the place, and it's kind of bright in there, and all the graphics in there look really good as well. So there's certain parts of this game where I think the graphics look just incredible, but there are other parts where it's kind of crappy.
Yeah, it's game I'm gonna check out as soon as I get the chance. But Steve, yeah, you chose the blue on this one.
The blue, it, other than the lab, it was also running a good close pick for my top demo material, and the reason being is just because it looks so flipping good, and because it takes you to a place that's real, but a place where you can't really go easily. I personally love to scuba dive and snorkel, so just being under the water is an incredible experience. And this game, for being one of the early titles, it still stands up and holds its ground for looking incredible. The whale encounter, while being my favorite one in general, it I think it's probably not the best looking one. What stands out more are the other two experiences where you're kind of on the coral reef and you have the sea turtles coming by, and you have all the coral, and everything just looks real, but in a rendered kind of way. You know, some games do this kind of photorealistic kind of realness to it. And we talked about that recently with First Contact. This one kind of maintains a depth of realism, but it's also a little bit cartoony, almost like a Pixar movie, but a touch more real. And the way they rendered the coral reefs and the sea turtles going overhead, and then all the you get flooded by just a I don't know what the correct term is, but a swarm of jellyfish. It looks really, really good, and it's really believable. And then the other experience they have is you kind of in this night dark setting, and you come across one of the I think they call them an angler fish, where it's the kind that has a little glowing thing off of his head that he baits. And in that setting, they updated it a month or two ago, and it ends with a giant squid kind of coming in place, and it just all looks so good, and I just love the setting too, and it probably helped tilt the odds in its favor.
Okay. And yeah, my choice is Showdown, and we'll talk about recency bias on this one, because I don't know if everybody remembers, but in the last show, Steve sent me a little bit of homework to try Showdown, and being the conscientious kind of person that I am, I went straight ahead and downloaded that. I didn't really know what it was before I played it, but this is an incredible, very short little demo. It's just an action scene, really, that you move through within VR. So it's been rendered in the Unreal Engine, and it's just like I say, you're just moving through this action scene that's taking place in slow motion, bullet time, really. And yeah, I mean, it's the graphics in this took me by surprise, because as I say, I didn't know what to expect, but just the reflections and the way everything is rendered so well. I mean, you've got objects in this. I mean, we can talk about games that have good graphics, but certain parts of them are not rendered particularly well. In this, as far as I could see, because it was a showcase for how good the graphics can be within VR using Unreal, it just looks incredible to me. And yeah, maybe given a bit of distance from it, this may not have been my choice upon reflection, but it's just still so fresh in my mind that this really stood out and I had to put it on this list.
It stands out for me, and I did it a long time ago. But since you related it to last episode, I'm curious, did Bullet Train borrow any of that kind of look? Or that was the question which really caused me to give you the homework.
Yeah, well, I think you mentioned the boss at the end of Bullet Train. It looks very similar to this thing that's in Showdown, you know, the big robot at the end of the street. Mm-hmm. It looks very similar to that. I don't know if it's exactly the same asset or not, but it does look very similar. I wasn't paying attention as much as I probably should have been to compare the two, but yeah, it does look very similar to that. Okay, and we're going straight over to Anthony for our next category.
Yeah, so now we're still doing our top five on the Vive, and we have now got to our number three pick on the Vive Game of the Year. Steve went ahead and chose the Brookhaven Experiment. Gary has Doom 3 BFG, and I went with Space Pirate Trainer. So why don't we just go back to Gary? He was talking about Doom 3 a little while ago. Maybe you can kind of finish up on that a little bit.
Yeah, there's not really too much more to say because we've gone over this on past shows as well, just how great Doom 3, the BFG VR mod is. And yeah, I can only really reiterate what I've already said about it. It's something that everybody should try. You can pick up Doom 3 relatively cheaply at the moment, and the mod is free. It seems to be updated quite regularly as well. So you can get you get anything you're not quite happy with, you can be sure that within the next few weeks, it'll probably be ironed out. But overall, yeah, it's just a great mod. And I had to put it on this. It impressed me so much when it came out. So yeah, I'm happy I put it in third place.
Okay, I'll talk about Space Pirate Trainer real quick. Space Pirate Trainer, for me, to put it up high as number three like this, it's weird because I have... I went through different phases with Space Pirate Trainer. Like when I first bought it, it was kind of the first big game that I kind of bought for my Vive. Like previous to that, I bought a couple of games that were like under $10. And then this one was $15. And it was kind of like the first big one that I was going to buy, even though, I mean, $15 isn't much anyways, but it was just the first one of that category. And I bought it and I played it and I was like, oh man, this is incredible. This is almost as good as like a ride at Disneyland or Universal Studios or something. This was back when I first got VR. And it was just the immersion of, you know, the drones that kind of fly around that you're shooting in Space Pirate Trainer. They will zoom over your head, you know, and be behind you and it'll be up there. And just the immersion of when they fly over your head and enter in your actual space, that really blew me away. And then also getting shot by these things. I remember this must have been a really early episode of the Vivecast way back when I was doing that. But I talked about how one of those drones shot me, and the shot, you know how like when it shoots, it goes in slow motion, and the shot went zzz, and it just aimed and it hit me right in the middle of my chest. And this is like the very first time I was playing the game, and it hit me right in my, and it's almost like I just naturally like, you know, like I felt like I'm dead. This thing shot me. I'm dead. And I think I even went to the ground. I was so like caught up in the whole thing. And I'm like, I'm not dead. And then it was almost like I just started giggling to myself. Like VR is just, this is crazy. Because I should have been dead. I got shot right in my chest. I'm not dead. But Space Pirate Trainer, over the months, like I kind of got bored of it for a little bit. But then I went back to it at one time because what I would do is I would turn off the in-game music and I would just create a playlist of whatever songs I was listening to, that songs that kind of would hype me up a little bit. And I would just play music and be shooting all the different drones and having my music in the background, but hearing the sound effects of Space Pirate Trainer. And so I kind of used it for that for a little while. And then the last thing I'll say about Space Pirate Trainer is they recently did an update. Well, it's a couple months ago now, probably, but it was the kind of update where everything was just so refined. And now when I play it, everything is so clean and so crisp and there's no more hitchiness and everything just runs better. And then they also added some new weapons. And one of them was this grenade launcher, which I've already talked about, but you shoot that grenade and then you hit the button again to cause the grenade to explode. And I had so much fun getting a good feel for that grenade launcher and actually making it to farther stages that I never got to before, because I really started to get good with that grenade launcher. And so a lot of love for me from Space Pirate Trainer, but it is a very narrow focus. And they're like Steve said, there's no story. It's a simple arcade game. So you have to understand that as well. Okay. So Steve, why don't we go to you? Brookhaven Experiment.
Brookhaven, it's similar to you. I kind of had a coming and going kind of feel with it where I kind of got tired on it for a little while, but it's just the kind of the total package. You know, they did give it a little bit of narrative, and it was before I kind of had wave shooter fatigue. Is really when I was playing this the most, and it, you know, the graphics were good, the setting was good, the whole ambiance felt good. The gunplay was good. You had a variety of weapons. You have something that I feel is missing in Arizona Sunshine, and that if a zombie gets close, you have melee available to you to kind of bail you out a little bit. You know, it's a solid game, and I think one of my fondest kind of memories of Brookhaven Experiment isn't from actually playing it, but it's from before I got my Vive. I saw the infamous YouTube video of Grandpa going to town on the zombies. I think everybody's seen it. If you haven't seen it, Google it or YouTube it. You know, it's just the grandpa going. He ran out of ammo and he just runs all over the room meleeing the zombies. And I remember thinking, like, holy cow, that looks like so much fun. So it was one of the first games I picked up when I got my Vive. I just have relatively fond memories of it. I don't really have too much to say in terms of the actual game specifics itself. It's been talked to death, and I think everybody's familiar with it. It's just a good overall experience, and it's something. It's further down on my demo list for people that come over, but it is one that for any extended demos or someone that's played with my Vive a few times, it's one that I eventually work them into.
Okay, and we also have our third favorite PSVR game. And Anthony and Steve, we're going to go ahead and give our third favorite PSVR game. And then we also had Gary make a list of three PSVR games that he would most like to play if he had PSVR. And so we'll also have his third choice for that. So my third favorite PSVR game is Battlezone. And Steve went with Rush of Blood. And then Gary, for the third game he'd most like to try on PSVR, is the Resident Evil 7 demo. So why don't we go ahead and... Actually, I'll go ahead and start off real quick with Battlezone. So Battlezone is a game that... It was one of the very first games. Actually, you know what? What I'll say is this. If it wasn't for Battlezone, I wouldn't have a PSVR. Okay, so if Battlezone was not going to be one of the launch PSVR games, I don't think I'd have a PSVR, which is actually an unfortunate thing because it would be a mistake because there's so many other good games. But Battlezone was the game that I saw that got me excited in PSVR, and then I tried it at a Best Buy, and it got me more excited because I tried the real game on a regular PS4, and I thought, wow, this PSVR is not... I thought it was going to be really lame. You know, I thought it was going to be like Dreamcast graphics in VR because I just didn't think the PS4 could do very much. But I was like blown away by how capable it really was. And that led me to get PSVR in the first place. And then I got Battlezone as one of the earliest PSVR games that I got. I don't have it right now. It was one of those Gamefly games. But this is another game where the second this game is like $29.99 at Amazon, bam, I'm going to buy it because there's a lot of goodness to this game. One thing I'll say is, like, when you're in that tank and you're moving around in the tank, the movement is so smooth to me. Moving forward, moving back, swinging over here, shooting at that guy. Just the movement is so smooth. I don't get any nausea at all. I'm perfectly fine when I play this game. The graphics are relatively simple, but they're clean and crisp. So I got a lot of love for Battlezone. Steve, you have Rush of Blood as your number three. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, with Rush of Blood, it's very peculiar because the, before the PSVR came out and once, the week or so before and the embargo was lifted, it seems like most of the mainstream media, but most of the primary gaming media sort of panned this game and were like, oh, blah, 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 it's not very good. It's just a stupid on-rail shooter and things like that. So, my point in saying that is I think they were all very wrong. I think that all of us consumers have nothing but positive things to say about Rush of Blood. It's just a very good shooting game. The setting is good. The creatures are good. The gun mechanics they work real well. For what they are, and it's just overall, it's just a fun kind of. It doesn't do any one thing terribly well, but the total package just made for a really fun experience. And I found myself, I think I beat the game in two, maybe three sittings. You know, I was just able to, ooh, that level was fun. Let me do one more. Oh, that was fun. Let me do one more. Next thing I knew, an hour had gone by. So it's a good game. It has good scare elements. You know, more the in your face kind of Saw movie type and less of the psychological horror type. And I recommend it to anybody who isn't easily scared and put off by the initial horror.
Okay, Gary, so on this one, you don't have a PSVR, but there's still some PSVR games out there that you are excited about. And we had you make a list of your top three, and coming in at number three is the Resident Evil 7 VR demo. What is it about this that makes you really want to try this out?
Yeah, well, I've played through the demo. I don't think it's the same demo, but just on a standard PS4, just on the TV. So I've played through that demo, and it seems like a really good game anyway without the VR element. But from all the footage that I've seen online of the VR demo and just the general word of mouth, I mean, I know Steve had this as his favorite VR demo of the year as well. So it's just these kinds of things that I'm hearing about this game has really sort of spiked my interest, and I'm very interested to try this game. Not a lot more to say at this stage, obviously, because I've not tried it, but yeah, it's one that definitely I'd be interested to try.
Yeah, quick shout out, Leicester, England. There's got to be somebody with a PSVR that could hook my boy Gary up and let him try some of these little experiences. Okay, let's see. The next on our list. Okay, Gary, you got the next one.
Yeah, this is an interesting category, actually. This is our third favorite Oculus game. Now, none of the hosts on VR Roundtable actually own an Oculus Rift, but we do try quite a few of the games, actually, through Revive. And so this category, it's going to be a little bit interesting because these are games that we've either tried through Revive or they're just Oculus Rift games that we would like to play in the future at some point. So with this category, Steve and Anthony went for Superhot as their third favorite Oculus game, and I went with Dead and Buried on this one. So why don't I kick it over to you two to discuss Superhot for a bit, because I want to talk about this one as well, actually.
Steve.
Okay. Well, yeah, I had a chance to play this about 4 or 5 days ago, and it kind of lives up to the hype. I was pretty ignorant. I don't say ignorant. For whatever reasons, I hadn't watched any videos or wasn't really aware of Superhot. So it comes out and Oculus Touch drops, and next thing I know, everyone's talking about this game. And I'm like, why? What's so good about this game? And so I got a chance to play it, and now I know why. It's a very, very simple game with these sort of stripped down polygonal created figurines. They're like a low poly count, solid colored bad guys. And the whole game, really, your objective, it's kind of like a puzzle game disguised as a shooter. And what you got to do is you got to get through these little short action sequences and figure out the best way to take out the bad guys without getting shot yourself or being punched by a bad guy. And, you know, it almost sounds, you know, if you haven't played the game, it would sound silly to hear someone say that it's a puzzle game disguised as a shooter. And it's really what you got to do. Once you get through a few levels, you have to figure out through trial and error sort of what you need to do. And if I back up a second, you know, to describe the mechanics, it'll make even more sense. When you're in this game, when you don't move, time doesn't move. And if you stay perfectly still, everything stays perfectly still. And then as you move or as you shoot your gun, the scene plays out. It's very similar in a way to that Quintero demo thing that came out a few, and that you can control time. You can't really rewind in Super Hot, but you can at least manipulate how it advances forward. So in any one particular stage or quote unquote puzzle, you may have three or four bad guys that you have to take out, and you may get through it on your first time just by natural awareness and dodging and shooting, or you may die three or four times learning at which point, you know, a bad guy is going to come around a corner or pop up or shoot you. So it's a very, very unique game, and I applaud it for that. And then one other kind of quick thing I'll say is that one of the cool sort of effects of it is if you shoot a guy with, say, a handgun, and he's in your, say, a 5-foot proxy of you, his handgun will fly out of his hand and it'll come at you slow enough in certain way that you just kind of reach out and grab it. So it has that sort of Bruce Willis and Die Hard kind of badassery to it. Like, you just take a guy out by punching him or throwing a vase at him, and then his handgun flies out and you catch the handgun in midair and you turn around and shoot two more bad guys coming around the corner. You know, this is just a very clever game, and I think it's really, really good.
Yeah, go ahead, Anthony. What are your thoughts on Superhot?
Yeah, I mean, it's mostly the same as Steve. It's kind of like a John Woo simulator, basically, or like Jet Li or somebody, you know, like Jackie Chan type of thing. But Jackie Chan doesn't shoot a lot of guns. But in this game, like you're saying, yeah, you'll shoot somebody, their gun will go flying up. You'll grab their gun, you'll shoot this guy, his machine gun flies up. You grab the machine gun, you start mowing these other guys, you know. And the visual aesthetic of it is interesting because it's kind of a little bit Mirror Edge a little bit. It's like these white rooms that don't have much going on at all. And then you have your enemies that are, they're like crystals. They're like human bodies that are made up of like these crystals. And there's not a lot of stuff in the environment, very simplistic environments, completely white. You don't even see like the end of the environment and stuff. It's like just like whiteness almost everywhere. And you get your gun and you shoot the crystal guys, and like, you know, they break up in slow motion and the crystals go flying everywhere. And there's like good sound effects and stuff to it. The only thing I will say to kind of caution the Super Hot hype, because I, around the internet, I've seen a lot of people, like I've seen a lot of people on NeoGAF say this is the best VR game there is, period. And maybe I haven't gotten far enough into it to see that, but it's a really cool game. It is super cool. And you'll be playing it, you'll be like, oh, this is the coolest game ever, because the gun pops up, I grab the gun, I shoot that guy, I punch this guy, you know, and you do all this cool stuff. But then after a while, I was kind of thinking to myself, well, they're just going to do all these little action vignettes over and over again. And it's, I don't know, the substance of it. And then the revive factor. It is a little bit difficult for us with revive, where the controls aren't necessarily built for us. And so you get to certain parts of the game where there is a little bit of weirdness there, but it is super cool. I mean, it's a cool visual effect, and it's like a John Woo simulator, and it's pretty damn sweet.
Yeah. I think it's awesome that you described a game titled Super Hot as super cool.
Yeah, I really enjoy this game as well. It's one that I started playing sort of last week, really, but yeah, I did hear people describe this as you say, Steve, as a puzzle game disguised as a shooter, and I couldn't wrap my head around it until you start playing it. That's when it really clicks, and you really do understand what people are talking about when they describe it like that. But there's so many aspects of this game that I like. And, you know, these guys that are coming up towards you, and you can just punch them. You don't have to use guns. You can just punch them, and they'll shatter before you. And you can go crazy. I mean, I was punching these guys like I hated them. I didn't they mean nothing to me, but it's really satisfying to do this. And you can also sort of, if they get close enough and point the gun at you, you can just grab the gun out of their hand, and then they look at the hand as if, what the hell happened there? And when you're playing this game in certain sections, you do sort of feel like when you're dodging all these bullets and they just can't get a hit on you, you've got to be thinking, these guys must think I'm awesome, because the way I'm just moving with such ease just to dodge all these bullets. But yeah, it is a puzzle game. And maybe if I'd have thought of that before, I could have put it as my favorite puzzle game. I don't know if that would have passed or not. But I think it's a great game. And yeah, I can't stop playing it. I just really do enjoy it. But my choice for the third favorite Oculus game was Dead and Buried. And this is one that I've not actually played yet. But from, again, all the videos that I've seen online, it looks an interesting title. Now, I didn't know when I put it on this list, but I think it's primarily a multiplayer game, and I'm not really that much of a multiplayer guy in general, but I'd still be very interested to try it. And I think a lot of people do enjoy this game. So yeah, I think it's got its place on favorite Oculus Rift games. Okay. And let's pass it over to Steve for our next category.
Our next one is, coincidentally, with Gary describing, talking about multiplayer, it is the best multiplayer game of 2016. And we do not have any group consensus, so I'll go ahead and Anthony has chosen Rec Room, Gary has chosen Onward, and I chose Rig. So let me kick it over to Anthony.
Yeah, for me, I'm not a multiplayer guy, first of all. I'll just straight up admit it. I don't know what it is about multiplayer, but I think what it is I have certain windows of time to play a game. And so when I think of multiplayer, I want to like play with people I know, people on my friends list and stuff. And it's almost like you have to like be like, okay, so 3 p.m. we're all going to meet up and we're going to play this game or that game or whatever. And a lot of times my life just doesn't work like that. So I kind of like the single player games where you're following a story and you could play as much of it as you want to, or as little of it as you want to, and nobody's depending on you and you're not holding any team back and stuff. So I'm not really a big multiplayer guy, but Rec Room, a free game on the HTC Vive and also now on the Oculus Rift as well. Rec Room is just a cool game. There's just a lot of cool things that you can do in this game, and it's multiplayer in so many ways. It's multiplayer just in the lobby. You can just go into the lobby and like do a lot of dumb stuff with other people there. You can hear them talking. You can sexually harass somebody. I've seen it happen live. The very first time I was in Rec Room, there was this one Japanese lady, and these guys had huddled around her and were saying all kinds of horrible stuff. And the Japanese lady had no idea what these guys were saying. And she was just laughing and giggling. And these guys are... So, I mean, there's a lot of crazy stuff that can happen in Rec Room. But also, you do have just a regular, like, paintball gun game that's in the game where it's kind of like a little shooter game. And for a couple of weeks there, oh my God, I was playing this every day. My kids were playing it. You teleport all over the place and you're shooting people with your paint guns and you get shot by other people. And like people will hold up, they'll like do this with their arms, you know, with their little floating hands or whatever after you've been shot, and people yell stuff at each other and stuff with their headsets and stuff. So I had some fun. Again, not really a multiplayer guy, but Rec Room was pretty cool.
All right, Gary.
Okay, I've chosen Onward this time for this one. And again, like I said before, I'm not really a multiplayer guy either, but this game was another one that took me by surprise, and that's really why I had to put it on this list. An honorable mention to Pool Nation VR, because that was another multiplayer game which I really enjoyed. But for me, this one, I think it's the surprise factor that the reason I've put it on here. And when I first got this game, I wasn't expecting very much. I was almost half expecting to refund it, if I'm being honest, because because I'm not just not a multiplayer guy, I'm not very good at multiplayer games. I'm not very good at specifically multiplayer online shooters or anything like that. But having played this game and spent 2 hours in it immediately after I purchased it without taking the headset off, I just got sort of drawn into it. It's an incredible game. And I'll admit, I've not really played it too much recently, but it's not that I'm opposed to going back in. It's more the fact that there's so many other titles to play at the minute. I'm looking forward to getting back in there and playing a few more rounds of Onward. But the game can be played in two different ways. You know, you can play with the team, and this is the other thing about it. When I went in, everybody just wanted to get on and play the game, and everybody was helping each other out, explaining all the little mechanics of this game, and that helps no end in multiplayer games when you've got a good community behind it. And going through the game, you can play it in a very, very serious way where you're all calling out to where the enemies are and you can move around the map and try and get to the objective. But at the same time, I had a lot of fun in a couple of matches where everybody in the lobby on both sides of the on both teams actually agreed just to have like a friendly match, and we'd just meet up in the middle of the map. And then what were we doing? We were actually playing a sort of a quick draw type game where we take 10 paces, turn around, somebody shout shoot, and we'd have to shoot each other. And it worked really well, and we're just having a great laugh in there. So again, I think a lot of the reason why I'm choosing Onward is because when I played it, the community was just so friendly and just wanted to get on and just have fun in VR. So yeah, that's why I chose that game.
All right, I was pretty close to choosing Onward. And the reason why I backed out and went the direction of Riggs was because of the learning curve. I remember, like you, I spent some time in Onward in the beginning, and I haven't jumped back in because it just seems more involved to kind of get going. You have to really set out and be in the right frame of mind.
Yeah.
And but when you are in that right frame of mind, there's probably no better multiplayer experience. But enough about that. I went in the direction of Riggs for sort of the opposite reason, in that you don't really have to be in a particular frame of mind. You can just kind of hop into it easily, and the convenience of the way the game is set up and that it was done by more of a professional studio, and they made it easier to hop in and into a game and get going, and just kind of more casual. You know, it wasn't as intense. In the game itself, you know, I love Riggs. I've talked about it a lot. It's probably the single VR game that I've spent the most hours in. But given it a multiplayer focus, given that it was kind of casual and easy for me to get into, and but also because it has the shooter aspect, which is kind of a key element to a lot of people into multiplayer games, all your dude bros with Call of Duty and Battlefield and whatnot, but also because of the sports. You know, it kind of married one of the very popular games still to this day, I'm sure, even though I don't personally play it, is Rocket League. So it kind of has, even though it's not the same type of gameplay, it has sort of a feel because of the sports angle as Rocket League. And I think as more people get VR and maybe give this game a chance, that it could still kind of, you know, 6-7 months later have a decent user base. And recently also the developer, Guerrilla, they've released an additional map for free. And they've got, over the course of the next 3 or 4 weeks, additional free DLC. You know, I think this week they release a new map. Next week they're releasing new rigs, new robots and things like that. So they got some good DLC and kind of extended support going to keep the community alive, which is very, very critical in when you have such a small user base of hardware to begin with. And with that, I will kick it to Anthony.
Okay, our next individual category is something that we don't think a lot about, but we probably should think about this more, is the sound quality. What about the 3D sound in these VR games? One thing that VR is bringing to the table is they recommend you use headphones in VR games because of the positional 3D audio, where you can hear that there's a zombie coming from 10 feet over in that direction because they actually put that sound in that spot. So we have a three-way tie here. We did not come up with a consensus. Gary has Trials on Tatooine. I have First Contact for Oculus, and Steve has Robinson the Journey. Why don't we go ahead and kick it over to Gary for Trials on Tatooine? What was the thing that blew you away there?
Well, I struggled a little bit with this category because, as you say, Anthony, this isn't something that a lot of us think put too much thought into when we're playing these VR games, although it can stand out in a good way in certain ones. But for me, as I was going down my list trying to pick a title for this category, as soon as I got to Trials on Tatooine, that immediately stuck out to me. And that was because really the sounds that you experience in this are very familiar sounds. You know, we've got Star Wars sounds. It's all sounds that we've heard growing up and millions of times over the years. But you're experiencing these sounds within this experience in a brand new way, where you can look all around you and see all these sounds coming at you from different directions. And it really did make a difference to my choice. That familiarity of these sounds and yet experiencing them in this way was really why I chose it. And I actually played it yesterday just to double check my choice. But yeah, it really blew me away.
Okay, and Steve, you have Robinson the Journey. What about the sound really impressed you on that one?
So, in full disclosure, I probably don't pay enough attention to the 3D sound. And I should, so I'm going to make it a point to do that. In retrospect, and after listening to some of our discussions today, I would probably, if given the choice, maybe change my answer to Space Pirate Trainer because of utility and because of function. You know, when the robots are going overhead, it gives you actual positional cues that you, the player, respond with. But that's not what I chose. And so I did go with Robinson the Journey, and I chose it more because of the ambiance it created. There was no functional relativity to it. And, you know, I didn't respond to the audio to turn around because a bad guy was there or to pick up on a clue or anything. But because, you know, you had bugs buzzing and birds chirping and pterodactyls flying and creatures crawling around on the ground, and you had the bubbling tar pits. So it just helped kind of create a sense of life. And I think they did a very, very good job with the audio. So that's why I went with Robinson.
Okay. And my choice is First Contact. And that might sound like, when you first hear that, you might be like, First Contact, really? Why? But what it was is I was in that demo. And if you're standing facing the front part of that demo, there's, you know, the robot is there and there's these monitors and stuff. But if you turn all the way around and kind of look behind you, there's these little bouncy balls that are on the table, like these little tiny bouncy balls. And if you pick one of those bouncy balls up and you bounce it on the ground, the audio that you hear after that is incredible. I give absolute props to whoever worked on First Contact and actually worked on the sound for those bouncy balls, because it sounds so perfect. Oh my goodness. I kept bouncing the balls over and over and over again. And there's other noises in that game as well. Like there's some cans, like cans of soda and stuff, that make little clanky noises. And then like when you pull the rockets and the rockets go shooting off, they make some nice noises and stuff. But it was just the bouncy ball. It was so amazing. Okay, so we've been going for a little while here. We're going to take a quick little break, and then we'll be back for some more categories. We're going to take a quick little break right here, and we'll be right back. Welcome back to part two of VR Roundtable's Game of the Year Awards. Okay, so let's see, where are we at now on the awards? Steve, I believe you have the next individual award.
Yes, our next category is Best VR Horror Game of 2016. And I just want to say that horror is such a key kind of thing with VR now. They can do things that you can't do with kind of traditional flat gaming. And horror is such an interesting category because you kind of have two types. You have the more raw, in your face, scary things, zombie, spiders, what have you. But then you have this other type, and that's particularly for me, the more kind of the scarier part is the psychological type, you know, the tension that is created, the, you know, you don't know what's going to happen. You're really tricking yourself. You've built something up in your mind before you see anything. And that is really good horror. And we've had a few really good games to take advantage of that. So as a group, we have agreed that a chair in the room wins that title for us. Although we weren't unanimous, myself and Gary did choose A Chair in a Room, and Anthony chose Until Dawn, Rush of Blood. So we will kick it to Anthony to talk about Rush of Blood.
Yeah, so Rush of Blood, it's crazy that it's just this roller coaster experience. It's almost like a light gun game. But if you have the two move controllers, you can decide to play it with the two move controllers, and you're basically just sitting in a chair and you're on like this slow moving roller coaster, but a lot of stuff happens along the way and it kind of gets weird, and there's just a lot of cool things that they do with this game. And I didn't play A Chair in the Room, so it appears that that is a very awesome game, and I'll have to keep my eye on that. Although that psychological stuff, like Steve was saying, sometimes it's the thing that you're most afraid of. Your mind will, you're in a dark room, you hear some kind of noise, you know something's behind that door, and you'll create something way more terrifying than any artist could ever think up. But yeah, my choice is Rush of Blood.
Okay, Gary, do you have anything you want to add on A Chair in the Room?
Yeah, well, we've spoken a little bit about this game, so I won't say too much. But yeah, it is a great game. And for me, the thing that stands out, I think the guy who made this must have some kind of degree in psychology or something like that, because the way he presents it, the way the game is directed is something that stands out for me. And he just seems to know, there's certain cues that you pick up on when you're playing this game, and everything seems to be placed with such care and such detail. And the story itself is very good as well. It's given to you in sort of fleeting glances, really. So it's difficult to tell exactly what's going on from the beginning, but a great game, and a good, yeah, absolutely one of the best horror games in VR.
Yeah, we've talked about it and enough here, so I won't get too deep. I'll just kind of reiterate that there are several sequences in this game where you really trip yourself out. I talked about the previous one in the bathroom, but there's another experience. You're in this little kind of like a storeroom, kind of back room thing of a, seems like a store or something. There are these shelves and the sounds, and you never really see anything other than a hand and an arm come out from underneath a shelf. But the thoughts that were going in my head and what I was expecting, and you know, big spoiler alert, but a lot of the game centers around the idea of a young boy that drowned. And for the longest time, you think that you're just kind of waiting to meet this dead boy, and mixing children, especially dead ghost children with horror and NVR, it just creeped me out. Like, you know, it's one way to tug at my heartstrings is to anything bad happening to a kid. And it just, this game was very, very, very creepy. So I'll go ahead and we'll send it for the next category, and that goes to Gary.
Okay, yeah, this one is the best moment of immersion in a VR game. So it's not necessarily the VR game that has the best immersion overall, but it's just one specific moment within a game which stood out to us is really having that sense of presence. So I chose Vanishing Realms, Steve was in for Budget Cuts, and Anthony went for Irrational Exuberance. And let's hear from Anthony first this time.
Yeah, so Irrational Exuberance is interesting because it's one of these experiences that we got way back when the Vive first hit. And it's not really a game. It's more of like an experience that they put you in. But basically for me, the reason why I had incredible immersion in this is because I really didn't know what to expect when it first started up. And you're kind of like in this cave, and there's these little pieces of rocks that are kind of floating around, and you have these two circular things that you're holding, and you can kind of hit the pieces of rocks and they break into a bunch of other smaller little pieces. And so you're just kind of in this cave and you're doing all this stuff and you don't know anything crazy is about to happen. And eventually you'll get a larger piece of rock that you hit, And then it goes twirling off and it collides against the side of this cave. Well, what I thought was a cave. And a big giant chunk of the cave breaks off. And then I see, oh my God, I'm freaking out in outer space. And like comets are shooting by and stuff. And it got to the point where a bunch more chunks of the cave that you thought you were in break off. And you're just left out there in space. And for me, that was back at the time when I had more of a fear of heights in VR, and just being out there, like where I could fall off of this thing out in the middle of space, just freaked me the hell out. And I got a really good moment of immersion just when I was breaking those blocks. And then when that block broke off, it was like, oh shit. So that was it for me.
Yeah. Steve.
I chose budget cuts, and the reason I chose that, in hindsight, it may not be the most immersive game as a whole, but like Gary mentioned, we're kind of aiming, we're trying to target a key immersion moment that we all had. And for me, one of the key ones and one of the early ones was with budget cuts. And I remember this, you know, I had shot a portal, portal. And I didn't move all the way through it, but I was poking kind of my head into it and was basically peeping around a corner and trying to catch a robot that was on patrol. And it was just kind of at that moment that I felt like I was really in that place. Like I was really there in that office complex, and I was really trying to evade this robot, and it just stands out. And I'm really excited for budget cuts to eventually come out, and I'm almost concerned for it that it's gonna have this cult like you know, No Man's Sky type of letdown. I hope it doesn't, but it just has, I have so many fond moments from that game, and this was one of my first experiences in VR, and it'll be one of the fondest I think that I'll have for a long time.
Yeah, for me, it was Vanishing Realms. This was one of the first games I played in VR. So it really stands out for me. I'll say it again, when you first experience VR, you go through a lot of these experiences that really stand out to you. And it takes that extra little bit. To really feel that sense of immersion. So the game or experience really has to be special. But for me with Vanishing Realms, it was just the opening section, really, where you're standing in that hall with the four pillars in each corner. Then you've got that surface where the gem appears with the shaft of light going down through the ceiling onto this surface. And yeah, it was just, as you've said before, Anthony, the walls and everything just seemed so solid. You're in this cartoony world, and yet the walls and everything seem really solid, as if they really were there. So for me, it wasn't a difficult choice. It was something where I got an immediate sense of presence in that section. So for me, Vanishing Realms, the opening hall section. Okay, let's kick this over to Anthony now for our next category.
Okay, so now we are at our second favorite Vive game of our top five. So we're getting closer and closer to number one. Gary has Arizona Sunshine as his second favorite Vive game. Steve has A Chair in a Room. And I have The Brookhaven Experiment. So let's go ahead and kick it over to Gary on Arizona Sunshine.
Yeah, well, this game, it's obviously one that's just come out. We've played a fair bit of it, and I think it's difficult for me to not include this in the list, because it's just got a certain level of depth and polish to it that just raises it up to that next level. And you know, I've got to mention the problems, because we've all experienced them. We've got crashes with it and all these little things that keep happening, and it does take you out of it, and I wish they weren't there. But I still find myself going back to this game again and again, and I think it's not very often I get a game which really, really draws me into the point where I can't wait to get home from work and play it again, you know. And this is one of those games. Super Hot with it was another one, but this was the one that I'm mentioning, and I think it's great. So yeah, there's not a lot more to say, really.
Okay, my choice was The Brookhaven Experiment, and Steve has already talked about this a little bit, but what I want to say about it is I have a broken controller. Okay. I have one of my Vive controllers is operating at like 70% efficiency or 80%. It works most of the time, but every once in a while it starts trailing off into the distance and I have to like recharge it or something like that. But what happened was, is I was playing Brookhaven. That is why the controller broke. And I've talked about this before, but one of my favorite experiences in VR is playing Brookhaven and just having the knife. And that's all I was using was the knife, okay? And so I was letting these zombies, because what you find out is if you let the zombie get close enough to you where it seems like it's too far away for you to reach it, but it's barely close enough, you can lunge out and slice them right by their neck. And you can take that head right off of the body. And am I on mute? No, no. Okay, sorry. Thought I was on mute there. But basically, it's just taking these zombies' heads off and being immersed in the world. I was so caught up in it that I was like, pretending I was like Michonne from The Walking Dead, and I was just like swinging super hard. And it's almost like I think I compared it one time where it's similar to if you're in a dream and it's like a kill or be killed dream, and something is going to kill you or you're going to kill it. And it's like, oh my God, I got to kill this thing or it's going to kill me. And that's exactly how I felt when I was playing Brookhaven and I was slicing these zombies' heads off. And I ended up way out of my play area and I smacked my controller on something. And it was because of that immersion and just being so immersed in it. And I have a lot of love for Brookhaven Experiment. So that's kind of my take on that. Steve, you have a chair in the room, number two.
So I very well could have chosen this as my top Vive game. And, you know, we've already talked about it, what, two or three times now on our awards here. And I just think it does a lot of things really well. One of the key things that I find when I really like a game is if I think about it when I'm not playing the game. Maybe I'm walking to my car after work and I'm thinking about the game, or, you know, if it pops into my head, and that's how Chair in the Room was. You know, when I wasn't playing it, it kind of popped into my head several times. And it's a good game that does a lot of things right. And, you know, when we started the show, I kind of mentioned one of the things that I look for, you know, is narrative. And I look for, you know, it doesn't have to be the best at everything, but it has to do a lot of things right. And that's what Chair in the Room delivers. It has a good narrative, you know, reasonably well narrative. It has a good graphical setting, a good kind of ambience and a good environment. It has, you know, the mechanics that what you're trying to do, although simple, it works well. And one of the things that I haven't talked about, and we don't have a category for it, I don't believe, is its actual use of room scale space. To me, this game used room scale space really well because it dynamically, as long as you had the minimum room space requirements, which I believe was 2.5 meter by 2.5 meter, the game would dynamically scale all the rooms to your room scale. So it was one game where I actually went into and kind of hacked the config files in Steam VR so that I could disable my chaperone entirely. And I never bumped into anything because the walls in the game matched up with my play space. And so that really, really, really helped with immersion. And I finished the back half of this game in one setting. So I think I played it for 3 hours straight, never taking the headset off, which is something, you know, I can play games longer than I think most people, but I've not played a game for 3 hours straight, never taking the headset off. So, you know, this was just a really, really good game for me. And I think if you haven't played it, I think it's one of the must plays kind of in VR's infancy first year, that so long as you can withstand the horror. That's the one tick that kind of takes it away from the wide general audience is the horror aspect. But if that doesn't bother you, then I think it's a must play title.
Alrighty, our second favorite PSVR game, we're getting farther down this PSVR list. Number two for Steve is Riggs, and number two for me is Robinson the Journey. And then Gary, we had Gary, of course, rank three PSVR games that he was most interested in. At number two, he has Star Wars Battlefront X-Wing VR Mission. Why don't we kick it over to Gary, if you have a few words about this?
Yeah, well, I am a Star Wars fan. I mean, I don't do any collectibles or anything like that, but I am a big fan of the films. I really do like them. And coupled with just my general interest in space and liking spaceship games, really, this really is something that I'm looking forward to trying out whenever I get the chance. And yeah, from what I've heard about this game, it's coming a lot across pretty well, so I think I'll enjoy it for what it is. I know you guys have tried this as well, but maybe because just based on my interests with this, I think maybe I'll get a little bit more out of it. And yeah, I'm really looking forward to trying this one.
Okay, Steve, your number two is Riggs. I know you've already said a little bit about it, but up
Yeah, we
there at
talked
number
about
two.
Yeah, we talked about Riggs with the multiplayer, and I'll just touch a little bit on the game itself. And I know I've talked about it plenty of times on the show before, but I love Riggs. It is a very, very, very good, very polished game, and it's one of the VR games that gets us close to that coveted AAA. You hear about it so much, AAA, AAA, polish. Give me a reason to buy one of these expensive headsets. Give me a reason to be isolated from my family, my kids, and my dog. Riggs for me is one of those games, and it's if I was playing it on a flat gaming, I probably wouldn't like it as much, but it leverages the benefits of VR. It gives you a reason to come back to it. It gives you a sense of quality, so you're not dealing with characters in the game where the arms are bent backwards because it was developed by an amateur. And again, I really not dogging on amateurs too much. It's just a fact of the industry, and Riggs just checks so many boxes, and I love it. And I haven't played it as much the last few weeks because of so many other titles to get through. But I plan on getting into it here during holiday break some, and I just it, I can't really. I'm struggling to talk about it because I don't want to really drag the time down talking about it too much. But there's really nothing that it does poorly, other than maybe some of the repetitive loading sequences. Outside of that, it does things really well. I don't necessarily give it an A plus in everything, but I give it a B plus, A minus in damn near every element of a game design that you could have.
All right, and I picked Robinson the Journey as my number two. And Robinson the Journey, man, what I'm looking forward to in VR is I really do want to be immersed in another world. Like, take me to some other place. Let me get lost in your world. That's what I want to do. And Robinson, of all the games I think I've played this year, Robinson may have come the closest of all of them to taking me to this other world. And there are certain things about Robinson that isn't going to appeal to everybody. You're not shooting the dinosaurs. There's no combat. There are certain things that are probably going to turn people off from Robinson. But for me, it was like exploring the world, scanning all the different creatures. In fact, I got addicted to just like I wanted to scan every single living organism in a certain area that I was in before I moved on to another area. There would be four moths that are flying around, and I want to scan all four of them. And I want to scan that dragonfly, and I want to scan that iguana, and I want to scan this mouse that's scurrying across the landscape. And I want to scan all of them, and it's almost like a collectathon type of thing. Or kind of like a Pokemon Snap or something like that. But going through that world, and the story is pretty good, and the sound is great. Robinson is a great game, but I know it doesn't appeal to everybody. But for me, I really love Robinson. Okay, so Gary has our next category.
Okay, yeah, this one is our second favorite Oculus game of 2016. And oh Jesus, are you ready for this, Anthony? This is going to set Steve off. Because both Steve and I chose Lucky's Tale for this shout out, and Anthony chose Dead and Buried. So we'll go straight back to Anthony, and so he can talk a little bit about Dead and Buried first.
Yeah, Dead and Buried. I have not played Dead and Buried, but I wanted to rank it here because I have this feeling that maybe Oculus, of all the money that they've spent on every game that they've made so far, that maybe the most has gone into Dead and Buried. And I feel like that polish, I mean, that money is probably going to pay off with a highly polished game that feels really good. I also remember the Tested guys playing Dead and Buried and talking about how much they like that. I think I heard somebody else talk about it as well. But basically, I didn't know it was so much multiplayer, though. I thought there was more of maybe a single player part of Dead and Buried. So I'm not super excited about how it's like mostly multiplayer, basically. But I don't know. It just seems like it might have a lot of polish and be a really fine-tuned product for them.
Okay, and Steve, now's your time to shine. Let's hear about Lucky's Tale.
Shout out, buddy. Shout out, my little buddy. So, you know, we Lucky's Tale and the shout out, you know, every episode has kind of become a little inside joke for us and or for me particularly. And
yeah, for you.
The game, though, it was one of those key pivotal moments. You know, this whole episode and is really us reminiscing about our kickoff into VR. It's its first year, and Lucky's Tale was a moment when I realized not everything had to be first person. You know, I remember playing the game and I was like, holy cow, this works. This opens the door for Mario. This opens the door for, you know, turn-based RPGs, which we still don't have any of. This opens the door for so much, and Lucky did it so well. And I think, you know, and Nintendo has Mario as their mascot, and you know, Sony tried to do it with Crash Bandicoot and stuff, and then Sega had Sonic the Hedgehog. Lucky could be not just Oculus's mascot, but it could be the mascot for VR almost. You know, I know Sony would never sign up for that, but and it just if you like video games and if you played Mario growing up as a kid, and if you you know, have a VR, and if you jump into this game and don't appreciate it for at least a half hour, something's wrong with you. And that's the way I look at Lucky's Tale. It opened the door, and it shows, and what backs me up in making that statement is the way people with PSVRs only responded to Robots Rescue in Playroom VR, which could be penciled in here as a similar title, although shorter in length. It unlocks something in people to make them realize that VR doesn't have to be shoehorned into this first person category itself. So I haven't finished Lucky's Tale, but I love it for what it represents.
Yeah, I can only echo that, really. I think it's a great game. And even without VR, I think it'd be a perfectly adequate, well, actually a perfectly good platform game. I think people dismiss it as saying it's not a great platform game, but in VR it's got this extra thing. I don't think that. I think it's a good platform game even on its own. I think it would be, but especially in VR, it really it's great. And the fact that it is third person and we can enjoy it like that, and like you, Steve, I think the same thing. It does open the door to really, like you, exactly the same. I was thinking it's got to be first person. VR is all about first person, but this opened the door and made it so that I could see how these types of games could be good. Okay, but let's go over to the next category, and Steve's got this one.
So I have our best film or storytelling of 2016, and I'll let it speak for itself. Another aspect, so I'm not going to let it speak for itself. Another aspect that surprised me with VR, that I wasn't aware of it going in, that it, you didn't even have to be playing a game at all. You could be watching a movie, and I don't mean video, because as we all know, video itself is kind of broken in VR when you spread it out in a dome in 360 degrees. What I'm talking about are the rendered kind of Pixar quality little short films, and we have a handful of them, and kudos to Oculus Studios for getting a lot of them out there, but there are a few available on Steam as well. So that's what this category is. It's for the Henrys and the Invasions and things like that. So Gary and I have both chosen Allumette, and Anthony has chosen Lost. So I will send it to Anthony to see his take on Lost.
Yeah, Lost. I just remember back to the early days when I first got Revive up and running, and I was trying Henry and Lost and a lot of the different little things that they had. And Lost just stood out to me because when you're in Lost in the very beginning, you almost feel like you're in like Jurassic Park or something. There's something kind of spooky about it. It's like nighttime and you're in like this jungle and there's something that's moving around in the brush, but you don't really know what it is quite yet. And then you see this thing, which actually looks very much like a raptor, almost like a robotic type of raptor or something like that. But you come to realize that it's actually a hand of a giant thing. And so, I mean, I don't want to spoil the whole thing, but it's just a really cool, short kind of cinematic movie type thing that I like it because there's a sense of fear. You're kind of scared. But then when you kind of realize what it's all about, you realize, oh, this isn't a scary thing. This is more like a sense of wonder. But in the very beginning, if you put somebody in there, they might get a little freaked out by it. And then it's like the sense of wonder. And I just like that combination, basically.
Yeah, I was very close to choosing Lost. I thought it was great. But I did go with Alumet. I don't even know how it's properly said, but because I think its little story was more of a heart tugger because of, you know, the mom dying or whatever. And it
spoilers.
Everyone knows the spoilers. But also the kind of the claymation stop motion stuff. There was this show that I watched as a kid, and my wife and I have gotten my children to watch it briefly. It was called Pengu or something like that. It was this little stop motion penguin. And this reminded me a lot of that. And I thought it was really cool how they could take something that is inherently low in quality. You know, no one really does that type of animation anymore. You know, it almost reminds also of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer that comes out around this time of year. So taking something that's inherently low fidelity, mixing it with a good little story, and putting it in VR, you know, I think it was a really, really good and artistic type thing to do. Gary?
Yeah, I agree. I think the story of this, because I wasn't expecting anything from this really, but as soon as you go in there, you know, the animation is very good right from the beginning. And the story progresses to the point where it's only very short, but, you know, you go from really being almost not caring really what happens in the story. You're just enjoying the animation for what it is. By the end of the little film, it's, you like you say, it really does tug on your heartstrings a little bit, and that's really why I've chosen this one, because that's what sets it apart for me from some of the other ones. Although I have to say, I don't think I've tried Lost. I thought I had, but hearing you describe it, I don't think I have tried that one.
What? Oh man, yeah. You really got to try that.
Yeah, you definitely do. All right, our next category goes to Anthony.
Yeah, okay, so we've been talking about a lot of really fun things about all the stuff that we love, but we should also talk about what the most disappointing game of 2016 was. And we, of course, did not agree on this category. Everybody had their own choice. Gary went with Adrift. I went with Island 359. And Steve went with Everest VR. Why don't we go back to Steve? What's your thoughts on Everest VR?
I'll keep this short and sweet. The game was short and sweet. You know, that was the biggest problem, right? Like, you
too
know,
short.
It was hyped up, and you know, it was really sold as this amazing experience, and it's similar to the Baloo. It tapped you. It was going to tap a real geographical location here on Earth that not a lot of people have the opportunity of experiencing, and that's climbing Mount Everest. And so it had all this promise and this marketing behind it. I'll give them kudos for that. And then it comes out and it was so short, and B, the second thing, it felt so unfinished, because in the beginning you do this kind of tutorial section, and then you don't even use half of the mechanics that they teach you in the beginning tutorial. Or if you do, you only use it one time. So it kind of left a bad taste in my mouth of feeling so unfinished and kind of rushed out the door to kind of meet a quota or something. So, and I know I'm not the only person that felt this way. It was really kind of panned the day it came out.
All right, Gary.
Okay, yeah, I'll keep this one short as well because I could go on about this. But the thing with Adrift is I was looking forward to it. This was one of the titles that I had seen before I got VR, and I was looking forward to playing this game. It was originally a gamepad-based game, but then I heard that they were implementing Vive controller support. So I thought I'll wait for that. And when it eventually got Vive controller support, it also went on a discount. So I thought I'll pick it up now. And when I tried it, the Vive controller implementation in this game is the worst I've ever seen. It's ridiculous. You don't have the whole point of having the Vive controllers is that you have your hands in that space. With this, their implementation is that you have the Vive controllers, you point something, and then you see the animation of the astronaut move his hand towards it and grab it. So you don't have direct control over the arm, over the hands, which is the whole point, really. For me, playing it with the Vive controllers is next to pointless. So I actually went back to playing it with a gamepad, and I enjoy it a lot more with the gamepad, although I can't get over that initial disappointment with it, really.
All right. And the one that I picked is Island 359. And this one, it was the developers that made the Brookhaven Experiment demo. It was basically two main guys that did that. They left the company that came out with Brookhaven Experiment, and they started their own company, and their first game was Island 359. And I have a feeling, I was really excited about this game before it came out, because it's like dinosaurs. It's the guys that make Brookhaven. They did such a good job on that demo. These guys know how to program. That demo is great. And now it's going to be dinosaurs, the first game in VR to really have dinosaurs and put you out there in a place where you could see dinosaurs. How awesome would that be? But when I got the game, ultimately, there's just a number of things about it that just don't quite work out. And it's not actually a horrible game, but I put it as my most disappointing because I think the potential was so awesome of what maybe could have happened, and it still might happen because this is an early access game. They're still adding stuff to it. But for me, I guess the disappointment is really like you shoot these dinosaurs. They all die in exactly the same way. All the little compies that are running around are exact clones of each other. All the raptors are exact clones of one single raptor. Same thing with the Allosaurus, and now they added Triceratops. I'm guessing they're all clones as well. I just think the developers could have like maybe changed the size of them and how fat and skinny they are, or maybe some of the coloration of them, kind of like a random thing to make it a little bit different. And then the death animations, it's only two guys that are working on this game, and then they probably have a couple other people in their company, and that's it. But maybe what they needed to do is to try to like outsource that to some other third party that could make better animations or something. I know it costs a lot of money, so maybe it's just not reasonable to think, but that was my biggest disappointment of 2016. Okay, so let's go to the next award. Gary, you got it?
Yeah, this one is the best third person perspective game, and this is the first time I think we've got a unanimous decision in our awards, and we all went for Lucky's Tale. So Steve and I, we've spoken about Lucky's Tale briefly. So we'll go to Anthony first and see his thoughts on this.
Yeah, I mean, Lucky's Tale, I've talked about this game before back on a Vivecast episode. And for me, what it is, it's like what Steve was talking about. When I played Lucky's Tale and it actually worked, I mean, one of the fears that I had about Lucky's Tale is you do have this automatic camera that kind of follows you. And so you always kind of wonder, is that going to make me feel weird or whatever? But I did it and I didn't have a problem at all. That camera was nice and smooth. It worked perfectly fine. And playing the game, Lucky himself, this little fox that is running around, like he's right there in the game and you can look close at him and it looks like a hologram, man. It looks like a hologram that is existing in your real world, and it's right there. And actually, if you if you're playing Lucky's Tale and you take your headset and he's like sitting over there and you move like really close to him, he's actually aware of that and he'll look at you and like wave. And it's just like when that moment of that happening, it's just, and it's like this hologram, man. It's like, I got Magic Leap right now. You know, this is a hologram right here. And just playing through Lucky's Tale. And then the world itself, you're playing a platformer, but you can look all around the world and there's like a river over here. There's a waterfall over there. You look up there, there's shooting stars or whatever. Incredibly colorful. Some of the graphics in this game and kind of the way the game moves along and it slowly guides you along, it kind of reminds me of It's a Small World from Disneyland, which I know that sounds really bizarre. How does that compare? But It's a Small World in Disneyland. You're like slowly moving through, which you're kind of slowly moving through Lucky's Tale. And then how everything is so colorful and you get to these different kinds of worlds that are so colorful. So Lucky's Tale is awesome game. And the first thought I had after being in there was like Miyamoto. Shigeru Miyamoto, you got to play this. If you play this whole game, there is no way that he would not want to make a VR version of Mario or Donkey Kong or Zelda when you see this little character running around and how perfectly that works.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, Steve, is there anything else you want to mention about Lucky's Tale?
No, I don't really have much else to add. I've already raved on it enough. I will just say, the one additional really cool part is when you go underground, it's kind of the metaphorical equivalent of Mario going into the pipe. It's just really cool because everything gets smaller and it's something that I also really appreciated. This game is pretty cool.
Yeah. It's a great game. Okay. Let's go straight over to Anthony for our next award.
Okay, so here it is, guys. This is our favorite Vive game of 2016. And because this is one of our biggest awards that we're going to give out here tonight, because let's face it, I mean, we all own Vives. The Vive is a very big part of what we do here in the games that we look at. And this is our game of the year for 2016. So Steve went ahead with Arizona Sunshine. Gary chose Elite Dangerous. And I chose Vanishing Realms. So let's go ahead and kick it over to Gary for Elite Dangerous.
Okay, I could talk about this game for a long time, so I'll keep it brief and just try and hit the main points. But Elite Dangerous for me is my favorite Vive game of 2016, because with there's so many reasons really, but one of the things is with VR, you've got the thing that VR does so well is the sense of scale. You can be talking to NPCs and things like this and they appear as real people in front of you, the life-size people in front of you. But then you extrapolate that out to the point where you're playing Elite Dangerous and you're sitting in this cockpit of this ship, which is sometimes some of these ships that you can buy can be bigger than your living room. You know, these cockpits spread out really, really big. And to pilot a ship in virtual reality, which is that huge and it really has some weight to it, you really do feel like that, is an incredible experience. And even then beyond that, you then pilot this huge ship into a space station, which is enormous. And you're going into this space station and it's surrounding you. You know, you play this game on a monitor and you get a sense of the scale on the monitor, but it's nothing compared to when you're playing it in VR. And you can look all around you and you see all these even bigger ships taking off from their pads and flying around this space station before they leave as well. So this is something this game does better than any other game I can think of at the moment. It's got a sharp learning curve and it's not something that I can recommend you just going in just to try. I think you really need to put in a bit of commitment to get this game. And actually, I recommend probably playing a couple of hours of this game on a monitor before you go into it. I bought this game before I had VR and I played probably 3 hours before I even had a VR HMD. And it allows you to get to grips with all the controls, because there's a lot of controls, there's a lot of mechanics to this game. But once you've got that, and you put on the VR headset, and you're doing all the controls from a flight stick and throttle, you can really immerse yourself in this game, because your hands actually correspond. Although you're not using Vive controllers in this game, you're using a joystick and throttle, they correspond pretty accurately to what you're doing within the game. So you can really get immersed in that. So it's not without flaws as well. The problem with this game is it's set in space. So we all know the problem with God rays and the Fresnel lenses on the Vive and the Oculus Rift. And this game has this fault where it's not really a fault. It's the fact that it's set in space. You've got a lot of dark, and then you've got a lot of light sections as well. And this was initially disappointing to me, as well as the resolution and just the overall clarity of the display in VR initially. It's improved a lot recently, and it's still not there entirely, but it's a lot better. And I think it's worth just trying the free, it's got like a free arena multiplayer shooter section on this game that you can download separately and just give it a try. So you can try that. That's not the part that I enjoy. Obviously, I've said before, I'm not a multiplayer guy. The part I enjoy is the single player, getting really immersed within this world and really delving down into the deep mechanics of this game. Now, my Steam time on this game is something like only probably 10 hours or something. But that's only because I launched this game primarily through a separate launcher. And I must have racked up around sort of at least 40 hours, I would say. And most of those hours are actually within VR. So that speaks for itself. This is, without a doubt, the game I've spent most time in VR. So yeah, I'll leave it there. I could go on and on, but yeah, I'll leave it there for now.
All right. I'll talk about Vanishing Realms real quick. So Vanishing Realms, it's my number one game on the Vive. And man, you know what it is again, like I was just talking about, I want to be immersed in a world. I want to get lost, and I want to forget that I'm in my garage, basically. I want to be transported somewhere else. And with the Vive specifically, it's room scale. I got this big, huge area that I've created. I've moved couches out of the way. I had a projector that was right here. That projector got kicked to the curb. And the reason it got kicked to the curb is because I started off with a small area of room scale, and I kept finding ways to make it bigger and bigger and bigger, till eventually I'm like, you know what? This is like VR room, and I'm going to try to get the biggest room scale I could possibly get. And one of the reasons I wanted to do that is for a game like Vanishing Realms, where you just get lost in the experience. You're walking down these dark dungeon hallways, and you have a torch in one hand and you have a sword in your other hand, and the torch is lighting up, flickering against the brick of the wall of this castle that you're in. And then you see a window over there, and the moonlight is just shining through the window, and you have all the music and everything. And every once in a while, you'll hear a voice of like, what goes here? You know, you'll hear like some scary voice that like scares the crap out of you, because you haven't seen what the enemies look like yet. And there's plenty of criticisms that could be made about Vanishing Realms, about the fact that it's a very short experience, although the dev has gone in and added some different things and kind of made the original experience a little bit longer. And it is a game now that I think you could play through this a couple of times and actually get some good value out of it. But yeah, you'll say people talk about how it's short, or how it's like the most generic RPG of all time, or people will talk about how the skeletons, it's so easy to battle them, that there's no real battle going on there. And there's hardly a lot of voice work. You don't see a lot of human characters that are talking to you. There's a million criticisms you could label at Vanishing Realms. But the bottom line is, when I'm walking through some of those dungeon hallways and I'm in some of those rooms and that moonlight is coming in and a skeleton is coming at me and I got a shield in one hand and a sword in the other, and it just freaking, I'll lose myself temporarily. Time will pass, you know, I went in there when it was light and now it's dark outside, and I get lost in Vanishing Realms. And I was going through the game where I hated to see the chaperone boundaries. I didn't want to see my chaperone boundaries because it would take me out of the experience. So what I was doing is if I was in a long hallway, what I would do is I would walk a certain number of steps, then I would teleport ahead and I'd turn around and I'd walk back a little bit.
Oh, I did
and
the
then
same
I would
thing.
Walk ahead and I would do that over and over again. So I'm always kind of turning around and I would never see the chaperone. And I know that I'm tricking myself, you know, by doing that, but it didn't matter. I didn't see the chaperone and I would just get so lost in the experience. So for me, Vanishing Realms is number one. And I know, I will say it with the caveat that I know in 2018, I'm probably going to look back at Vanishing Realms and be like, can you believe that I had that as my number one Vive game? Because there will be people that will build upon this and make everything even better. But it's the beginning. I'm seeing the beginning with it. So that's why I have that at numero uno for the Vive. Okay, Steve, your numero uno is Arizona Sunshine.
So with Arizona Sunshine, we've talked about it a lot the last few weeks. So I'm going to talk less about the game itself and probably talk a little bit more about why I chose it. For me, I haven't played that game as much as A Chair in the Room or in case of PSVR Rigs and maybe even a few other Vive titles. But the reason I chose it is because I think it appeals to everyone. I was being sort of selfless with my number one pick, and I was thinking of the VR consumer as opposed to just me personally. And I think it's a game that most people will enjoy. The Walking Dead is a very popular show for a reason, and Arizona Sunshine is kind of the closest game we have to that. And I think it's a part also why Brookhaven was a big success is because zombies are popular. Zombies are all the rave. They're the trend now. And Arizona Sunshine gives you that. Arizona Sunshine, although using teleport, it gives you one of the best teleporting locomotion that we have. Arizona Sunshine gives you really good gunplay. Arizona Sunshine gives you really good graphics. Arizona Sunshine does a lot of things really, really well. And I think that, you know, and as it pushes closer to that coveted AAA boundary, and as it is something that the general John Q public would probably enjoy, it needs to sort of be, at least my opinion, maybe the spokesperson for VR right now. I don't think, like Anthony, I don't think looking back in 2018 or 2019, I was like, oh, well, Arizona Sunshine. But right now, I think it needs to be the bee's knees. And it sort of is. You know, a lot of people are talking about it. And, you know, we've had a couple of games released since then that have kind of been talked about. But looking back, and I really struggled with this, but looking back in all of the games that I played, I felt that this was the most representative of what the goals of VR was, you know, as it came out in 2016. So that's my reason for picking Arizona Sunshine.
All righty. So that brings us to PlayStation VR Game of the Year. This is the number one for Steve and the number one for Anthony. And then also we have Gary, what his most, the PlayStation VR game he'd most like to be able to play right now. So I went ahead with Until Dawn, Rush of Blood, and Steve picked Robinson the Journey, and Gary also has Robinson the Journey as his most wanted to play PSVR game. So let me just talk about Until Dawn real quick. I know I've talked about it a number of different times, but kind of in a summary, what one thing I'll say about Until Dawn is going into this game, it's like I get like a nervousness or like I worry about going into the game. Like I kind of have a dread sometimes when I play Rush of Blood, and it's because I know what I'm in for, man. This game takes you on a journey. The production values, there's just so much to Rush of Blood that I think is really high quality. There's certain parts in this game, I haven't played A Chair in the Room, so I can't comment on that, but there's certain parts of Rush of Blood where they will put a freaky creature right in front of your face for like a split second, and then it disappears. and different jump scares and stuff. And you're on this roller coaster and you're thinking, well, what can they really do with a roller coaster? But the roller coaster goes through buildings and it goes through rooms. And sometimes you're moving incredibly slowly and you're like in this big living room and different things happen. These creatures come out. There's this one battle you get into with this crazy guy with a mask and he has like axes and stuff. And that was one of the coolest battles I've ever had in VR, you know, and I was battling that guy and it was the end of a level. I actually thought when I got past that guy, I thought the game was over and there was still plenty of more game to go. And I haven't completely finished it. I'm probably at the last level and I've kind of been stuck in it. And, you know, I play it for a certain while, but what happens is you get to certain points where it gets kind of overwhelming and you die, but it brings you right back in it and you can go right back at it. But after a while I get overwhelmed. I need to take a break. But Rush of Blood, man, God damn, that's a good game. I just give it straight love. Let's send it over to Steve for Robinson the Journey.
So similar to Arizona Sunshine, Robinson is a game that we've talked a lot, given that it's been a relatively recent release. And my thought with Robinson, you know, is that it does so many things and it checks so many check boxes. The graphics are good. The scale, I don't think we've talked too much about scale today. The scale is impressive. When you first come across the long necks and then later on across the T-Rex, it's just, sorry, Anthony, if you haven't come this far, but when you come across these large dinosaurs, it just, the scale is impressive. In the jungle section, you're on this massive tree branch and you're trying to navigate your way through it. And then you just come face to face with a long neck, which we would all refer to it as a brontosaurus. I think, I don't know if long neck is a real breed or a real dinosaur in our sense, but at least I think of them as brontosaurus. But you come face to face with it and you have to give it basically something to eat so he gets out of your way. But when you do that and you're just standing there and I caught myself just looking at that dinosaur and looking down and thinking, man, his feet are like 65 feet away from where I'm standing right now, but yet I'm face to face with his face. And the game, you know, I mentioned the graphics, the scale, the audio, you know, gave a breath of life to it. The narrative, while not anything amazing, gave purpose to why I was this kid that crash landed on this planet and was trying to A, figure out what happened, but B, make sure I was set up to continually survive. The gameplay itself was probably of all things the weakest, because it's at its core, it's just a exploration with a little bit of problem solving and puzzles. But even then, it kind of ticked that box. It was like a really good role playing game without the, you know, the role playing battle, you know, without casting magic and taking potions and whatnot. You know, other than that, it kind of nailed all the role playing aspects. And in the end, when I look at all the games that I played in 2016 in VR across both the PSVR and the Vive, Robinson the Journey is one of my fondest memories as a complete package. And like with Arizona Sunshine, it was one of the things that I felt was the purpose and one of the goals of VR was to come around and say that you could have this type of experience. And for that, I gave it to Robinson and I recommend everybody play it. It's really, really, really good.
Okay. And Gary, you had Robinson as your number one most wanted to try PSVR game. A few words about that.
Yeah, I can't comment too much on this, obviously, without playing it. But this was a game that I saw before it came out, and it caught my interest then. So it was one that I really wanted to play before it came out. Having heard what you guys say about it as well, it just makes me want to play it even more. So yeah, as soon as I get the opportunity to, this is going to be a title that I'll probably pick up.
Okay, Steve, you got the next one.
So our next category is our favorite Oculus game of 2016. And if I stand corrected, this does not include games that we wish we would play, but only includes games that we have actually played. And obviously being via Revive, since none of us have an Oculus Rift. So I chose Chronos, which is a game I know we haven't really talked about any on this show. Anthony chose Lucky's Tale, and Gary chose Super Hot. So I'm going to send it to Gary.
Okay, yeah, I've already spoke about this, but yeah, for me, this is one of the games that just keeps me coming back again and again. I just want to play this game and see it all the way through. It's a great game and very, very impressive, and definitely, without a doubt, between this Super Hot and Lucky's Tale, I haven't played Chronos, but for me, this was an easy choice, Super Hot all the way for me.
All right, Anthony?
Yeah, I've already talked about Lucky's Tale quite a bit, and I'll just reiterate and say, if there's anything I want to say about Lucky's Tale is I can't believe it doesn't get more respect. You know, I can't believe more people don't rave about Lucky's Tale. It's a lot of people are like, oh, it's just a platformer. It's just a platformer in VR. Oh, that's just like a throw. Dude, no. Have you tried to play this game? Have you ever played a Mario game in your life? Have you ever played a Donkey Kong Country game or anything, or a Sonic or whatever? If you've ever played one of those games, play this for an hour and tell me it sucks. I can't imagine it.
Well, I have to be carrying water for at least 10, 15 people amount of praise for Lucky's Tale, right? I went with Chronos, which wasn't lucky. The reason I went with Chronos is because, like Lucky, it has that that third person feel to it. It was another moment when I realized that we could take games and make them work in VR, and that there was a value add to VR if it wasn't in first person. And you know, to kind of give the setting in Chronos itself, it's like if you take The Legend of Zelda, mix it in with Bloodborne / Dark Souls a little bit, and put it in third person and give it the feel of, say, Lucky's Tale in VR. And that's what this game is. It's a full 6-7-ish whatever hour campaign. The graphics are great. The gameplay is really good. Now, in terms of three-dimensional immersion, you know, it doesn't have a ton because it's, you know, it's a gamepad game. You're sitting in a chair and you're just kind of looking around. But all the other things it does, it does really well. And I don't think, you know, I think within the Oculus community, a lot of praise is given to this game. But in the VR community as a whole, I don't feel it got enough love. And it made me realize that if Sony wanted, they could just take God of War and just put it in VR with what I have to assume is a relatively minimal effort. And it can help that transition, you know, with all of my other top picks of the year. I tried to look for things that would help, you know, things that I personally enjoy, but also things that would kind of represent the industry and help, you know, kind of establish the medium as something valid. And Chronos is a good contrast to the other games that I picked, between Arizona Sunshine on the Vive and Robinson on PSVR. Chronos is different, but it's really, 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 really good. And I can only imagine that in the next, say, 6 months, that the price of it will probably come down. And I hope that a lot of HTC Vive owners, you know, take it as an opportunity to play it. And as an additional note, people that are willing to fiddle around that have only PSVRs, you can, this is a game that you can play via Steam, via Revive. You know, it's kind of a very indirect path, but with the Trinius, whatever, I can't say it, but with the pack or the app that was released, you can get your PSVR working on a PC and try this game out as well. It's been reported to work really well, and I may give it a go one try just to kind of verify how well it works. So Chronos is good and also highly recommended.
Okay.
And I'm sorry, and it goes to Gary for the next one. Sorry.
Yeah, this is, well, we're getting close to the end now, but this is the second unanimous winner of our list here now, and we're going to talk about our best VR RPG of 2016, and all three of us went for Vanishing Realms on this one. I'll just start quickly because I just want to make an honorable mention as well about a game called Push for MR. It's game. That,
I had a feeling you'd mention that.
Yeah, I had to. It's a, I think it's a great game, considering it's made by one guy. It's a good game. It's very rough around the edges, and it's not for everyone. But yeah, I've got. I just want to mention that as well. But yeah, there was almost no competition in this category for me. It was all about Vanishing Realms. It was an early experience that I tried, and it stuck with me, and I still think about it now. I think this is an absolutely fantastic game, and you can complain about it being too short, or it's sort of RPG light in many ways. I agree with that, but it does what it needs to do for VR at that point. And I'm hoping when the second part comes out, if it ever does come out, because I've not heard a lot about that, if it does come out, it sort of improves and builds upon the foundations of what we've played through in the first part. But yeah, absolutely well deserved from me. So Anthony, what did you think about Vanishing Realms?
Well, the only thing I'll say about it, see, I actually put this category after my Vive Game of the Year, because see, I wanted to rave about Vanishing Realms as my number one Vive Game of the Year. So I actually kind of put this category farther back than what we normally would have already been done with this. But yeah, man, it's just an incredible game for me. I love it. It's the room scale. I don't know of a better game in room scale. I know there's games that maybe technically take advantage of room scale in a better way, like Unseen Diplomacy and A Chair in Your Room and Job Simulator, where the room will scale, like it'll know how much room scale you have, and it kind of makes the room that way. And Vanishing Realms doesn't do any of that. But what it does is it just naturally takes advantage of room scale, because if you do have a space to work with, you can actually physically walk around within this dungeon. And that's what's so beautiful about it.
Yeah. Steve? Okay, Steve, what about you?
I don't think I've talked about Vanishing Realms yet. You know, I really don't have too much to add that you guys haven't already covered. You know, it's a great looking cartoony RPG game. Everyone immediately has thoughts of, you know, the original Legend of Zelda, you know, and really, I think that's probably what the developer was going for. So it really delivers on that aspect. It is a great game. And it is one that I show to my really gamey type of friends that come check out VR. You know, I don't think it necessarily appeals to the general public, but if you're a gamer's gamer and you grew up playing, like I said, Legend of Zelda and whatnot, Vanishing Realms will make you grin ear to ear. And that's why I chose it. And the only thing wrong with it, and you mentioned it, Gary, is that it wasn't maybe a little bit longer. And you know, maybe when part two, if and when it comes out, they can maybe improve on the locomotion a little bit. I'd like to maybe explore with the trackpad locomotion that's getting popular now because of Onward. I imagine that in there would maybe be more enjoyable, not having to teleport around, because I don't have the biggest of play spaces. But the combat, I tried the update with the increased difficulty and the combat and sword fighting with the skeletons. That was really, really good, really, really well done.
Yeah, that's one thing I'll just add to that. This is one of the games that really made me sort of hit my controllers against the wall now and again. This was one of the first ones that really made me do that. But yeah, great game. So I'll hand it over to Anthony now just to announce our overall winners.
Yeah, so just to kind of wrap it up, what we did with our top fives is, if we ranked a game number one, we gave it 5 points. If we ranked it number two, 4 points. Number three was 3 points. Number four, 2 points. And then the fifth ranked game got 1 point. And then, so what we did was, you know, collectively put it all together to see, do we have a consensus pick for game of the year? And basically Arizona Sunshine walked away with it for the HTC Vive. It ended up with the most points. I didn't have Arizona Sunshine on my top five, but Gary, you had it pretty high on yours, and Steve, you had it really high on yours, right?
Yeah, I think it, for me, I had to put it in my list at some point.
Yeah, I'll just say quickly, the only reason why I didn't also have it in my top five is just I've had so many issues with loading screens, crashing, and just little miscellaneous issues. And then also it's so new that I haven't had enough time to like step away from it. You know what I mean? And so, I mean, but it's a great game. It's absolutely up there. I would have it, like I had Cyber Pong and Raw Data. I think I had those 4 and 5. And Arizona Sunshine could have been either 4 or 5 as well, right there. And then a few other games like Windlands is another game I really haven't mentioned at all on this entire show. Windlands was kind of up there. Hollow Ball might have even got some consideration up there as well, and probably a couple I'm forgetting. But anyway, HTC Vive Game of the Year, Arizona Sunshine. Okay, and then our PSVR Game of the Year goes to Robinson the Journey. I had it ranked number 2, and Steve had it ranked number 1, and then Gary, of course, had it as his most wanted to try. You know, Robinson the Journey, like, I mean, Steve already talked about it for a long time, but it just puts a lot of it together. So that's that. Okay, now we have our individual top 5 overalls. So, Steve, go ahead. Just, this is your top 5 whatever, any VR game top 5. Go ahead and run it down for us.
So I went with Robinson the Journey on PSVR, Arizona Sunshine on the Vive. So it kind of goes with my ones, top ones I mentioned. Number 3 clocks in with Riggs. Number 4, A Chair in the Room. And number 5 with Chronos. So I was very consistent with what I put out in all the previous award statements. And I think if I had to put down 5 games that I recommend anybody play, those are the 5, you know, platform independent.
Okay, Gary?
Yeah. So my top 5 overall is pretty much my HTC Vive list. But yeah, so at number 1, Elite Dangerous, not a difficult choice for me. That was always going to be number 1. Then I went for number 2, Arizona Sunshine. Number 3, Doom 3, the BFG VR mod. Number 4 was The Gallery, Episode 1, The Call of the Starseed. And at number 5, Job Simulator.
All right. And my top 5... Vanishing Realms, number 1. Until Dawn, Rush of Blood, number 2 for PSVR. Robinson the Journey, number 3 for PSVR. And then I went with Brookhaven Experiment for the Vive, number 4. And Space Pirate Trainer for the Vive, number 5. So those are all of our awards. I don't know if you guys want to have any last second thoughts about anything, or yell at anybody for something they ranked in the wrong spot?
No, not really. It's it's been a big show, this one. It's we sort of tried to get through as many as we could, as many categories. So and we've tried to be as thorough as we can be as well on a lot of these. But you know, there's no point in talking over about games that we've already discussed on the show to death and all of this kind of stuff. So hope people have enjoyed this as well, and I'm sure there'll be a lot of people who can make comments in the video about how they disagree with us. I hope they do that, actually.
yeah. Actually, anybody out there, if you have some disagreements about how we rank them, either find our Reddit thread where we're announcing this episode, or go to the YouTube page of the episode. You could leave a comment there.
Yep, and I'll only add that we kind of almost welcome the controversy. Hey, award shows are inherently controversial because everybody has different opinions. And I think having the discussion and talking about why you like something better than something else, you know, only kind of gives the industry traction, you know? So I look forward to hearing what you, the listener, has to say, and tell us where we're wrong. Tell us where we're right. I'm right. you know, 2016, it's been a great year for gaming. January 1st, 2016, I would not have thought that I would have owned either VR headset. And here I am, you know, at the end of the year, I own 2 of them, and I've, minus Final Fantasy 15 that I'm playing with my son, I have kind of abandoned flat gaming altogether. And I can only speculate that 2017 is going to be even better.
Yeah. If you think about all the stuff that we've ranked, we've talked about a lot of different games, and all of this didn't start until April. Basically. And then the PlayStation VR didn't arrive until October. So next year, 2017, we're going to have 365 days of all of these things being available, all of these things being well established. And there's going to be a lot of exciting stuff to come. But I mean, we did have a really solid 2016 for our VR awards. So it'll be cool to see what happens next year and see how much better it can be.
We're going to have to take the day off for next year's award show, I think.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, this was a long show, guys, and we appreciate for you hanging with us. But we wanted to cover all of this. And once it's done, and we don't do it again until another year from now. So might as well talk as much as we can about all these great games that we got to mess around with.
Yeah, I agree.
All right. Well, that's going to do it for episode 15 and our awards for 2016 for the VR games. And that's basically going to do it. All right, man. See you guys later.
Okay. Thanks for watching, guys.
See you. Bye. Happy holidays, everybody.